This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it this. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Atra-g-g-g. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you much, Fred Foy, and hello everybody. Welcome to The Glowing Dial, presenting the greatest in old-time radio entertainment since 1996. Yes, off and on, that's how long we've been doing this program, with a few hiatuses in between. I'm Big John Matthews, your host. And joining me, as usual, my co-host and sidekick, Mr. Steve Archiver Bannock.
Hello, everybody.
Hello, hi. Sir. Mm-hmm. Glad you could be here once again. And we are celebrating.
Come over as often as I can.
Yes. We are celebrating Father's Day and presenting another tribute to those adventurous detectives. This time around on episode Pod 91 of The Glowing Dial. We have four detectives that we're going to present to you, and we also have some celebrity birthdays, four different segments of those, and at the end of that, we're going to tell you how you can find out who you share your birthday with, which celebrities. I think one of the ones I share it with is Albert Einstein. So that's kind of neat.
Mary Travers from Peter, Paul, and Mary.
Was she?
Mine.
Oh, your birthday is Mary. Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's a good celebrity to celebrate with.
Yes.
I love Peter, Paul, and Mary. I think there haven't been that many groups that do harmonies and things like that that bring a tear to your eye.
Mm-hmm.
They're one of them. ABBA was another. A few things by the Everly Brothers. Just awesome harmonies. Just, you know, wow.
Mm-hmm.
So, let's move along here. I've been listening to 50s on 5 and 60s on 6, Sirius XM. I've got it in the car, and my little Echo Dot right here will tune it in. I just got to make sure I don't say the A word and wake her up. Because then it lights up, and it's waiting for you to ask it to play something. I wonder if she's got the Stumbling Foxtrot. Probably not the version that we have, of course. Mm. Anyway, let's get to some celebrity birthdays, Steve.
Okay.
This is for the period June 9th through June 29th, 2019. We start with June 9th, 1891, Mr. Cole Porter.
Oh, yeah.
Born in Peru, Indiana. He was a composer. As far as old-time radio, he did the theme for My Friend Irma, which was a piece called Street Scene. And June 10th, 1903, our good friend, the Rooster Soup Man, Ernest Chappell. He was an announcer on the fabulous Dr. Tweedy, Quiet Please, Big Story, and Campbell Playhouse. And, I saw that episode of The Tonight Show that you talked about a few shows ago.
Yes.
Where, Carson's interviewing Orson and he tells the story of the Campbell Playhouse and he got a book or something that said that roosters make the best tasting soup. So he got the cast to say rooster instead of chicken every time. And Ernest Chappell's like, I know what you're doing to me. You're going to make me say that. And then Orson just paused and said, and he did. I don't know if it went on air. Maybe it just happened in a rehearsal. But
reminiscing about the old days, yes.
Yeah, Ernest Chappell. Great announcer and a wonderful actor, too. On Quiet Please, he really showed his abilities up there. June 11th, 1911, Long John Nebel, born in Chicago, Illinois. He was a radio talk show host all night long in New York City on WOR. He had a show called The Party Line, and he started talking about topics like UFOs and ghosts and are aliens here on Earth and somebody that claimed they made a flying saucer, all these kind of claims, or somebody that can channel, all this stuff he tackled. Of course, he talked to some decent people, too. I mean, not the UFO nuts, which there were plenty of, but scientists like Arthur C. Clarke, Jackie Gleason even called and talked to him about some UFO sightings. So Gleason had an interest in that kind of stuff, too. But he inspired people like Art Bell, George Noory, and Jeff Rentz to do those kind of topics. And, of course, some time ago, we lost Art Bell. And that was a very sad day when I heard that, because I really enjoyed his program. And every time I hear one of the tunes he used for bumper music, I think of him. Mm. So rest in peace, Art Bell.
Now, Mr. Nebel there, does he like filled donuts? Or does he like warm winter woolen wear under? Because his name is Long John.
I know.
Where does he get that from?
I was just hoping that joke would go away, actually. But continuing on, June the 12th, 1915, Robert Forster, born in New York City, was an announcer. The CBS Radio Workshop, Gangbusters, and 21st Precinct, which was a police drama. And lastly for this segment, June the 13th, 1892, one of the best Sherlock Holmes, in my opinion, Mr. Basil Rathbone, born in Johannesburg, South Africa. And, of course, he played Sherlock Holmes, and he was Inspector Burke on Scotland Yard's Inspector Burke. And that is it for the first segment here. More celebrity birthdays coming on a little later on in the program, and, of course, we'll tell you how you can find out who you share your birthday with. Now, Steve, I thought you had a couple of passings that you were going to mention
yes.
here?
Oh, yes. Passings. Yeah. Recent passings here. We lost Don Reynolds. He was the last Little Beaver.
Oh, okay.
The last person to play Little Beaver.
Good friend Frank Brzee was one of
them. Frank was earlier, but Don Reynolds was the last one, and he just passed. We also lost Marshall Brodeen.
Oh, my God. Boy, that is a name from the past.
Magician Marshall Brodeen, and he appeared for many years on Bozo. He was Mr. The magician guy.
Was he really?
Out of Chicago, the Chicago Bozo.
I just remember him from that annoying commercial. I'm Marshall Brodeen, a professional magician, to show you TV magic cards.
That was one of his products that he sold, yes. Uh-huh. But for many years, he was Bozo's sidekick on the Bozo Show out of Chicago, and he was the clown magician underneath the makeup there.
All right.
I don't remember the actual
role
of the clown that he played, but he was on there for a long time.
I remember seeing Bozo on Channel 9 out of Windsor, Canada. I don't know which version. Apparently, Bozo was a franchise.
Yes.
And many people would play
it. City had their own Bozo.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. So maybe that was Windsor's version. But that's the one I'm familiar with.
Yes. And the final passing, Ron Swede, who played the ghoul locally here in Detroit and in Cleveland, passed.
And yeah, and he was also syndicated to whatever Kaiser broadcasting stations, which was 50. And I think there was one in Cleveland. I think there was one in LA. But yeah, he used to host midnight movies. And he patterned himself after Goulardi, which was a late night movie host. You know, they all had to have a gimmick. Elvira, Goulardi, son of Goulardi, I think. And, Ron had met Goulardi and kind of became an intern with him. And, Goulardi kind of guided him along and let him use, once he retired, let him use the character, which Ron switched around a little bit to become the Ghoul. And, he was the reason to stay up late on a Saturday night for me.
Yeah, if you didn't go out on Saturday night, you could stay up and watch some of the Ghoul's antics there in between the movie that he played. You know, when they had a commercial break, he'd come in and he'd do his fun stuff.
And the films were always butchered, of course, you know, for cut to hell to make room for his segments and everything. Because I think he had a two-hour segment.
Mm-hmm.
And he would show films like Psychomania, you know, the biker horror flick from England, which has got a cult following now. They just did a magnificent restoration of it on Blu-ray. And I picked that up. It's not the same without the, cause the Ghoul used to cut in sound effects. You know, when somebody wiped out on a bike or something, he'd cut in, "Whoa, rip my jeans." And if a frog was shown, of course, he had the character of Froggy, and you would hear, "Hiya, gang, hiya." And he would do horrible things to the Froggy doll. It was just awful. And that's what they liked, this adolescent humor. That's what Ron specialized in with the Ghoul, was just adolescent humor, like, you know, pick your nose and flick the booger somewhere. That's the kind of stuff, you know, that makes you laugh and on a really primitive, childish level. And that's what he appealed to. And a lot of people loved him, and we're going to miss him. We're really going to miss him. So maybe more of his stuff will show up on YouTube now.
Mm-hmm. Hopefully.
We'll see. You know, with proper copyrights and all that kind of stuff. But rest in peace, Ron Swede. And thank you, Steve, for mentioning those. Okay. Long segment here. Let's get into our first program. It's going to be The Adventures of Frank Race. It's called The Adventure of 17 Black. It's from Sunday, May 22nd, 1949, and it was a syndicated program starring Tom Collins and Tony Barrett. Art Gilmore is announcing, and sponsorship, I think, would probably vary due to whatever market it was playing back in. Each market would sell their own commercial time. And, Steve, you have some information.
Tom Collins sounds like a drink. Probably is not.
No, I said that in the birthdays last time.
Right, yeah.
We had his birthday, we mentioned.
Yep.
So,
Adventures of Frank Race.
Yep.
As the opening narration to the show intoned, the war changed many things, the face of the earth and the people on it. Before the war, Frank Race worked as an attorney, but he traded his law books for the cloak and dagger of the OSS. And when it was over, his former life was over, too. Adventure had become his business. And business was good. The Adventures of Frank Race premiered in May of 1949. The intrigue of espionage during World War II was still in the minds of audiences. Frank Race carried the intellect from his former career as an attorney and added the cachet of experience with the OSS, Office of Strategic Services, forerunner of today's Central Intelligence Agency. When his service to his country was over, Race was not satisfied to settle down in a law office. Along with his associate, Mark Donovan, Race's adventures often began in New York, but took him all over the world. The program has been called a Johnny Dollar Meets James Bond. Race and Donovan do investigation for a major insurance firm, as in Johnny Dollar. Race's adventures will include a fistfight or two and a rousing chase scene. In these situations, Donovan, a former New York cab driver who hasn't lost the accent, is called upon to save the day. But with the other factor in Race's adventures, the attentions of innocent, beautiful, and not-so-innocent women, Race is on his own. This is, of course, the James Bond part of the formula. The series originally starred Tom Collins, former star of Shandu the Magician. About halfway through the run of 43 episodes, the role was taken over by Paul Dubov. The show was produced for syndication. It was sold to individual stations rather than the networks. Rather than advertising national sponsors, local businesses would advertise during the program. This accounts for the long breaks bracketed by organ music during the programs. Other syndicated programs also used this practice.
All right, and our McGee machine is so special it tunes those versions into it. It knows what we want to hear because it reads our minds. It's as simple as that. You know, kind of like Fibber McGee when he fixed his radio, his magic radio. He fixed it so it would tune in broadcasts from the past, and it kind of had a psychic link with him. And that's our gimmick, and we're sticking with it, okay? Okay, thank you, Steve. Mm-hmm. Let us get this program rolling.
Let me go over to the McGee machine and tune that show in just as we had wanted it. And this should be the proper setting for that program.
It is.
And
all right, folks.
Coming in now.
Sit back, close your eyes, and remember The Adventures of Frank Race. This is The Adventure of 17 Black from Sunday, May 22nd, 1949, originally in syndication.
The Adventures of Frank Race, starring Tom Collins. The war changed many things, the face of the earth and the people on it. Before the war, Frank Race worked as an attorney, but he traded his law books for the cloak and dagger of the OSS. And when it was over, his former life was over, too. Adventure had become his business. The Adventures of Frank Race. And now we join Frank Race for The Adventure of 17 Black.
Saratoga, city of sport and health, where you can watch the thoroughbreds come thundering into the stretch or increase your physical efficiency with its spring water and sunshine. But my sport of the moment wasn't taking place in the sunshine. And I'm afraid the healthful effect of its atmosphere was rather dubious.
Number 17, Black. And now you're coming up, Mr. Race.
Yeah, it's about time after what I've dropped here tonight. I'll let that ride again.
Aha! At last I find you, sir.
Oh, hello, Mark. Thought you were in New York.
Place your bets, please.
I was sent up here to find you. We gotta get going. Come on.
Won't you hurry? I'm busy.
You're gonna be busy. You've got a hasty task for Universal Indemnity. The embezzlement job, and they want you right now.
Number 17, Black. Looks like you're in the groove, Mr. Race.
I've got luck on my shoulder. Leave it right there, Eddie. I'm letting it ride.
Oh, no, he ain't, Eddie. Push it this way. We are heading for New York.
Yeah, but, Mark, I'm just beginning to win.
You ain't gonna win by leaving it there. Let's blow. This is important.
Place your bets, please.
Yeah, well, I suppose you're right. Come on.
Certainly I'm right. Nobody can keep playing one number on that thing. It just ain't in the books.
Yeah, hold on a second.
17, Black.
You say what did I tell? You won again.
Yeah, I would have won. You hadn't picked up the bet.
Hey, look, maybe we ought to go back and play that thing for a while, huh? Here, you're hot.
Come on, Mark. We're heading for New York. Who talked to you from the insurance company, Reed?
Yeah, Chest A. Reed. I told him you wanted a little time to yourself, but he said I was to get you anyway. He told me all about it, see, so I could brief you.
What's the story?
Some guy keeping books for a construction outfit took 70 G's of the company's money. He was bonded with Universal.
Reed wants me to go after him, huh?
No, not the guy. He's dead. Suicide. Reed wants you should see if you can find the dough.
Yeah, At Universal Indemnity, I got the details. The alleged embezzler had been a man named O'Connor with a home in Yonkers. I had Mark drive me over there to see his wife.
What's the use of talking about it? Johnny's dead. After a while, I suppose I'll be able to tell myself I've still got a baby.
Baby?
He's a year old.
How you fix the money?
I've got the rent for another month. Got some ground meat for supper. Guess I'll have to get a job pretty soon.
Didn't your husband have insurance?
$8,000 worth. But we'll never get any of it. Not if they call him suicide.
Oh, it should have occurred to me. How did he die, Mrs. O'Connor?
He was found in the garage, shot in the car. Carbon monoxide.
I see.
They'll never convince me that he committed suicide. Not Johnny. He enjoyed life too much. Why, he was right in the middle of making a crib for the baby. And if he stole that money, where is it?
I understand there was a confession.
A fake. Even if it is in Johnny's handwriting. Here it is.
I'm taking the only way out. When they audit my records, they'll find I've misappropriated $70,000. Try to forgive me, Johnny.
He never took that money.
Well, possibly not, but it's missing. And your husband is dead. If we're going to prove him innocent, you'll have to help me.
Oh, I'll do anything.
Did your husband have any friends in the company or particular enemies?
Irving Dalton, the chief accountant. He always treated Johnny like a laborer. See, Johnny used to carry a hod, but when the baby was coming, he took a night school course in bookkeeping to better himself.
Did Dalton hire your husband?
No. T.J. Thomas does the hiring. He's general manager.
Does Thomas have a financial interest in the company?
I think he owns a third. The rest of it belongs to Mr. and Mrs. Maynard.
Well, possibly Mr. Thomas can help a little. I'll see him tomorrow. In the meantime, take this.
Oh, no. I couldn't.
We'll call it a loan. You've got that youngster to think about. And for the time being, stay with your baby and forget about getting a job. Take me back to the city, Mark.
What's cooking?
Know anything about a family named Maynard?
Oh, certainly a hard bunch to get along with. The old man's a retired cement finisher. See, the boys, they don't believe in labor of any kind.
No, you're working the wrong neighborhood, Nate. Maynards I refer to are the big-time contractors.
Oh, big shots. No, I know. Rice.
What is it?
That's the dad behind us. What's that they're waving out the window? It's a Tommy gun.
Right. You better do some twisting. They're waving it at us.
Oh, I'm doing the best I can. You got a gun?
In my hand. But against that firepower,
he's cannon on me, Rice. We're going to get it. Okay.
Let me get my arm free.
Let me help.
He's coming up with that machine gun.
He's lining us up, Rice. He's gonna... You got him. The other guy's running.
Watch out. I didn't kill that one. Just hit him in the leg.
Yeah, but he lost the chatterbox. We're okay. Here, let me help you out.
Yeah.
Easy now. Take it easy. Yeah. What kind of a deal is this anyway?
Looks like a lethal deal, Mark. Somebody's playing for big keeps. You didn't go to an ordinary lumber yard to find the offices of the Maynard Construction Company. They took up half the 14th floor of a skyscraper. I was impressed by the handsome paneling, the ancestral portraits, and the cocktail party that was going on. Well, the place was rocking. It was only after quite a bit of elbow fencing I was able to force my way to a waiter. He promised to locate T.J. Thomas for me, but it was at least 15 minutes before I got a reaction.
Mr. Race?
That's right.
I'm Irving Dalton, chief accountant for the firm. You've been moving around, so you're a little dazed. You didn't come here on business, I hope. Not this afternoon.
What are you celebrating? Lifting of a mortgage?
Just a little party in honor of State Senator Humphreys.
All this for a state senator? What would you do for a governor?
I understand you want to see Mr. Thomas.
Yes, T.J. Thomas. General manager, isn't he?
That's correct, but you see...
And it says general manager on this door.
It also says private, Mr. Ayson, if you don't mind.
Yeah, it's a long elevator ride up here. I'd like to conclude my business this time.
So if you ask me, I don't think it's a good idea.
Really, darling, no one asked you.
Hold it a second. If you don't mind, this is rather private. Sort of board meeting.
No, I don't mind at all. I'm most anxious to talk to the board.
Now, wait a minute.
My name's Race. I represent the Universal Indemnity Company. I'm here concerning the claim on your bookkeeper, O'Connor.
Oh. Well, in that case...
Come right in, Mr. Race. I'm Sandra Maynard. This is Mr. Thomas, our general manager, and my husband, Arthur Maynard.
What do you want to know, Race?
Several things. But first, I'd like to express a personal opinion. Your bookkeeper didn't steal anything, and he didn't commit suicide. He was murdered.
Dear me. Headlines. Headlines. Sandra, my darling, your Welfare League group will buzz about this one.
Oh, Arthur, shut up.
This is very interesting. Are you ready to prove that someone else misappropriated the money, Mr. Race?
Not yet. But that much money doesn't just disappear.
There's an outright case of embezzlement. The books speak for themselves.
I should think so.
Oh, of course. You know all about the records, don't you, darling?
I don't know what keeps me from clawing your face off. And I'm warning you, Arthur, if you don't stop...
Witnessing marital Donnerbrooks has never been to my liking, so I eased out of the room. And bumped into as delectable a bit of fabric as I'd encountered in several days. A tawny blonde with a benign eye.
You look sort of grim.
You know those people in there?
Sandra and Arthur Maynard? Sure I know them.
What's the pitch on the relationship?
You sound like someone sent out to watch the silver.
And I've run into a defendant of the family honor.
Oh, not me. I know them, but I don't play in their yard. And never will.
They don't get along. It's embarrassing.
Well, that's because they're going to be divorced. He used to be her teacher at college. I guess they never straightened it out.
Make quite a clatter out of it, don't they?
This whole party has turned into a clatter. I think I'll go home. You care to come along?
Most encouraging invitation I've had in weeks. Lead on, fair lady. Lead on.
What's the matter with that cab driver back there? Sounded like he was putting up quite a squawk.
Mark, no, he's a very unreasonable fellow. Just because he waited half an hour for me, felt he should drive us to your apartment.
When I've got my own car, he must be nuts.
Yeah, it's a night to send anybody by me, Doris. Full moon, sky full of stars. Perfect night for romance. Or murder.
What makes you say that?
Just a thought. Do you always carry so much luggage in your car?
I'm a nightclub singer. I'm going away for an engagement.
Oh, too bad.
Well, come with me.
What I do, push your piano around?
Race.
Yeah, maybe I should come along and push your piano around.
Come inside. Hold me, Race.
Delighted. But first, let's have a little light.
What are you doing?
Removing this pistol from your purse. What is it? Part of the new look?
Oh, Race, don't be like that. I'll go for you if you let me. I might even postpone going away.
How would you like to talk about a man named Johnny O'Connor and $70,000?
I might. There's something that might interest you in the bottom drawer of that bureau.
Seems to be stuck.
So are you, sucker. Nice work, Doris. Now we can get rid of this chump for good.
We'll return to the adventures of Frank Race in just about 1 minute. Now, back to the adventures of Frank Race.
I came alive regretfully. The hazy conviction that my head had grown at least double and was still trying to expand. I told myself irritably this was no procedure for establishing Johnny O'Connor's innocence, nor securing his insurance for his wife and child. Then I caught voices, and I knew my best bet would be to play dead.
Any sign of life back there, Rocky?
Nah, he's out cold.
Better take a look and see if he's coming to.
Relax, will you? When I slug him, they stay out for hours.
Well, flash a light on him and make sure.
Okay, okay. Out cold as a mackerel.
Ready. Here's the top of the hill.
You want him up front, don't you?
Yeah, right behind the wheel. Here, give me a hand.
All right.
This guy's big.
He's hard to lift, all right. Let's give another heave. Yeah. Sure, it's good. Now, pour the liquor over.
This ain't no new idea, you know. It's got to be done right or the cops get hep.
That's good enough. Now, put the car in high.
I want to stay. Watch you go through that guardrail on the curve.
Nothing doing. We're getting out of here.
All set.
Okay, then. Let it go.
I said to grab the wheel. The lurch of the car fooled me. Threw me sideways in the seat. I tried getting up, but the reflexes were off. That curve. I had to get control. If I didn't...
Don't ever do that to yourself. I just sat there for a few seconds. Then I staggered to a phone booth and... ask Mark to come out and meet me.
All I can say is it was your own fault. If I'd have been tagging along, it probably never would have even happened. I warn you about that dame.
Well, she's very attractive, Mark. In spite of what occurred, I shall continue to think of her wistfully.
She had a look. You know me, I never miss her dames.
I agree.
As the poet says, they're the most dangerous species.
Most dangerous of the species, Mark.
You take it from me, they ain't of anything. When it comes to working angles, dames are all by themselves. What are we going to do with this car?
Take it back.
It ain't cracked up as much as my cab was. Ain't a bad car at all. What's this?
Registration says it belongs to Thomas and Humphreys. Used car sales.
That's where we're taking it? At midnight? The joint will be shut tight in Atlantic City in December.
Well, let's get inside.
You know something? They could call this breaking and enter.
Do you mind?
Not so long as the cause is just. They need a new door here. You want my flashlight?
Yeah, street light's enough. You take that filing cabinet and see if you can find any papers on the car. I'll try the desk.
Okay. How do they file these things? By license number, make a car, what? I ain't having no luck.
Never mind. Take a look at this.
What do you got?
Here's a registration application for the car. Made out in my name. According to this, I own it.
Then unload it as soon as you can. It needs new rings and a rebore.
A tight little arrangement.
Look, I don't get it.
I do. If I'd been killed tonight, Mark, this slip would have been mailed to the Motor Vehicle Bureau in the morning. It would have covered my accident very nicely.
Uh-oh. Looks like you're up against tough pitching, right?
And there's more to this than just the missing 70,000. I wonder if I could squeeze any information out of Sandra Maynard.
Squeeze? Another dame? In this case, chum, that ain't good.
Well, you're wrong, Marcus. In this case, it ain't bad. Home of Sandra Maynard turned out to be one of those structures that a locksmith and a couple of carpenters could turn into a hotel over a weekend. The lady of the house greeted me in a sequence something that gave almost as much flash as she did. I instantly recognized one quality in her that I tabbed as dynamite. While you were with her, she'd make you forget all the other women you'd ever known.
After our scrambled meeting last night, this is rather unexpected. But it's nice. Cigarette?
Thanks.
There'll be drinks along the moment. Manhattans and martinis. I'm sure you must like one or the other.
There have been occasions when I've gone for both, to my eventual distress.
You're attractive, Race. But then I suppose you already know that.
You're rather direct, Mrs. Maynard. And I'm sure you make good use of the trait.
It saves time. Don't say Mrs. Maynard. I hate the name. Call me Sandra. Everyone does. Even my chauffeur.
I'm flattered.
I wonder, have I stepped off on the wrong foot?
With your facade, why worry?
Suddenly I do find myself worrying. Do you mind if I try to impress you, Race?
I think I'd enjoy it.
Why did you come to see me?
To talk business.
Can it wait?
I don't think it should.
Race, I have a feeling that you might be crusading.
Did you know Johnny O'Connor?
Do I look the type to know anything about a construction company? I inherited the thing from my father. I care so little about it, I've given my husband a quarter interest to get rid of him. What about your Johnny O'Connor?
He was the bookkeeper who was supposed to have committed suicide after embezzling $70,000.
And you don't think he did? Either one.
Well, it seems that he handled the expense accounts for the firm. Entertainment bills, items like that.
I don't get the significance.
The state's attorney general has been asking for funds from the legislature to investigate contractor bids for public works. Been complaints that your company's had inside information on supposedly sealed bids. So a lot of expense vouchers in your office became too hot to hold. Expense vouchers that might have been linked with the bribing of public officials.
Well, what does all this have to do with that bookkeeper?
Well, shall we say that with all those vouchers missing, say, $70,000 worth, O'Connor would be the patsy with nothing to back up the entries in his books. Especially if he weren't around to offer excuses.
I'm afraid you've lost me, Race. I let Thomas run the company.
And you know nothing about this?
Nothing. But I do know one thing.
What's that?
I'm glad you came into the picture.
Thanks. I'm gratified.
Oh, stop looking at your watch. You don't have to rush off, Race.
Yeah, it's getting late and I have another call to make.
On another woman?
On your chief accountant, Irving Dalton.
I want to see you again. If you'd care for my case history, I'm 26 and rather wealthy. In about 60 days, I shall no longer be encumbered with a husband.
An interesting deposition. Don't worry, you'll never be lonely.
There's nobody home, right?
Should be. This hour.
Yeah, why don't you try to knock?
There's nothing like the direct approach. Should have learned that earlier this evening from Sandra Maynard.
There ought to be a light switch here somewhere. That's better. Now we... All right.
Yes. It's Dalton.
Look at his throat. Somebody must have choked the wadden at him.
He must have been showing signs of weakening.
Let's get going, huh?
No, let's look around.
Uh-oh.
Open the door, but keep behind it.
Okay. Didn't know if it finds your wig, Dalton.
Take a better look, Thomas. You'll notice he isn't awake.
Say, what is this?
Well, I know some inquisitive gentlemen who'd call it homicide. Where do you think you're going?
I'm getting out of here.
Not yet.
I had nothing to do with this.
Possibly not. But I have a hunch we can tie you in with Johnny O'Connor's murder.
I had nothing to do with it.
Oh, then you know it wasn't a suicide.
No, I...
Mark, dial the Homicide Bureau.
Now, wait a minute. Why can't we sort of talk this over?
We can. Why don't you start in?
In the first place...
Race, look outside the window!
There were lights still on in the home of Sandra Maynard. I told Mark to drift around the grounds, keep his eyes open, and then I rang the bell. The butler, appearing in a robe, insisted that his mistress had retired. I had him take me to her bedroom suite where we found her still up. She dismissed the butler.
Do you mind if I go on brushing my hair, Race?
Not at all.
It doesn't disconcert you?
You know very well it disconcerts me, but at the moment there's something else.
What else, Race?
I just came from Dalton's apartment. He's dead.
Wait.
And so is T.J. Thomas, your general manager. Dalton was strangled. Thomas was shot.
Race, you're not serious. Who could have done it?
The police might think you did.
I? Race, you're kidding. You don't think I did it, do you?
The person who killed Dalton had the strength of a man. Do you have a pistol?
Pistol?
Have you ever had one?
Yes, of course, but my husband's had it for some time.
You can prove that?
Well, I think so. The butler knows that Arthur has had it.
But the permit was issued in your name?
Yes, it was, but...
There's a bullet in Dalton's apartment. The bullet that killed Thomas. The police are going to find it. When they check it in ballistics, your butler's testimony isn't going to be much good if they find that gun here in your room.
But I told you I don't have the gun.
I have a feeling that your husband is going to plant it here.
Oh, Race, I'm all upset. Why would he do that?
First, to cover himself.
When he gave him that interest in the firm, he decided to make it pay off in a big way. He got Thomas and Dalton on the hook, and they started the bribery pattern for big profits. But you're the principal owner, so he's going to try to tag you with the guilt. Another thing. If you were to be executed for murder, he'd get another big chunk of your estate, since he's still your husband.
Priest, what am I going to do?
Well, we can wait for him. Then, when he gets here...
I'm already here, Mr. Race. What's the matter, my darling? Lost your poise? Emulate Mr. Race. He's quite controlled.
That your gun he's holding, Sandrin?
Yes, that's it.
You've caused me a great deal of trouble, Mr. Race. The obvious suicide of O'Connor satisfied the police. Why didn't it satisfy you?
Johnny O'Connor didn't have your educational background, Maynard. He'd never have used a word such as misappropriated. Not even in a suicide note. He used the same word when I interrupted that office meeting. Even Thomas was satisfied with embezzlement.
You smelled murder in one word?
Two words. It was a simpler one. O'Connor would have said books. Thomas called them books. You used records. The note said records.
I admire superior intelligence, Mr. Race, but I'm afraid I'm going to have to dispose of you.
Be a bit involved, won't you?
Not at all. You came here to charge Sandra with crimes. She shoots you with the same gun that killed Thomas. Her gun, as you pointed out. She then commits suicide. Mr. Race, stop looking behind me as though there was someone there.
Ah, but there is.
I tell you, Race, you just can't beat an end wrench in a pinch. All you need is the right guy to flip it.
Marcus, never have I been so happy to see your ugly face.
Adventures of Frank Race, starring Tom Collins with Tony Barrett as Mark Donovan, came to you from Hollywood. The series is written and directed by Joel Murcott and Buckley Angel. The music is composed and played by Ivan Dittmars. Be sure to be with us again this time, 1 week from today, for another dramatic chapter in The Adventures of Frank Race. Art Gilmore speaking. This is a Bruce Ells production.
Hi, this is Frank Brzee, Little Beaver on Old Time Radio's Red Rider. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
We're back with you once again. I'm Big John, that's Steve, and this is episode Pod 91 of The Glowing Dial, where we celebrate Father's Day and present another tribute to those adventurous detectives. We just heard an episode of The Adventures of Frank Race. That was The Adventure of 17 Black. From Sunday, May 22nd, 1949, originally in syndication.
Sounds like a roulette number, 17 black.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Bingo. Oh, no, that's not.
That's not a roulette. That's
no, it's
bingo.
Not. Yeah.
Different game. Both have numbers in it, but yeah.
Yeah, I was gambling on that one. Sorry, Steve. Anyway.
And you lost.
We have three more detectives that we're going to present to you. Adventurous as they are. But before that, we have some celebrity birthdays to talk about. Steve has this next set.
June the 14th, which is Flag Day. Back in the year 1919, Sam Wanamaker was born in Chicago. Wanamaker what? Oh.
Wanamaker cry.
Wanamaker cry. He was an actor. He was Ellis Smith in The Guiding Light, which is a soap opera.
Long running.
Yes, my mom used to watch that one. And he was also in Lone Journey. Next, we have June the 15th, 1910, David Rose from London, England. He was a conductor, Red Skelton Show, The David Rose Show, and Bold Adventure. He hit number one with The Stripper.
Yes, he did.
He also did the music for Little House on the Prairie.
A show where you didn't hear the tune, The Stripper.
Right.
Yeah.
I can imagine Laura Ingalls doing the strip. No, it's not appropriate for the show. June 16th, 1890. Also from England, this time from Ulverston, is Stan Laurel, comedian, Ruth Lyons Show, The Laurel and Hardy Show, and Mail Call, in addition to many of their motion pictures, which were funny.
Oh, they were wonderful. Yep.
Love that man. He was hilarious. June the 17th, 1921, Ben Morris from Oklahoma City. He was an actor. He was Pat Novak in Pat Novak for Hire, and also in Dark Fantasy. And the last one of this set, June the 18th, back in 1898, born in Farnborough, England. We have a lot of England ones in this segment here. Carlton Hobbs was born. He's an actor. He played Sherlock Holmes in Saturday Night Theater Children's Hour.
Okay.
And that finishes that segment.
All right. More celebrity birthdays coming
up. More later.
A little later on in the program. Right now, it is time for another detective. And we're going to present The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. This episode's called The Dancing Hands. It's from Saturday, March 19th, 1949, over CBS originally, starring Gerald Moore, oh, Mr. Morbus, Vivi Janis, Ed Begley, Lou Krugman, Paul Frees, and Bert Holland. Roy Rowan is announcing the program, and the show was sustained. Now, Steve, you've got some information on Philip Marlowe for us.
The Adventures of Philip Marlowe, that I do.
Mm-hmm.
Raymond Chandler was never fully thrilled with the treatment radio gave his hard-boiled detective, Philip Marlowe. He allowed himself to be photographed with actor Van Heflin and producer Jim Fonda in 1947, but looked none too happy about it. It was thoroughly flat, he wrote to colleague Earl Stanley Gardner of the opening episode on NBC. Chandler's role was strictly ornamental. For both series, he was given pre-title or in-title billing, but he had no other role in the shows. The CBS series was somewhat more to his liking. A voice like Gerald Moore's, he wrote to scriptwriter Gene Levitt, at least packed personality. Indeed, Moore had one of those most distinctive voices on the air. This was not a cute series. It had a little of the Sam Spade charm, or the Richard Diamond flippancy. It was blood, guts, and thunder, and Moore's bassy voice carried it. Get this and get it straight, he harked, opening the show. Crime is a sucker's road, and those who travel it end up in the gutter, the prison, or an early grave. The story titles were of the genre, The Hard Way Out, The Last Laugh, etc. The music was loud and stinging, containing the essence of hard-boiled action. The show ran on NBC from June 17th to September the 9th, 1947, as a summer replacement for Bob Hope, and it was sponsored by Pepsodent. It also had two runs on CBS, the first running from September 26, 1948 to September 29, 1950 for Ford Motors. The second run was a somewhat shorter summer run, which lasted from July 7th to September 15th, 1951.
Okay. There we go. Thank you for that information, sir.
Naturally.
And I guess nothing remains but for us to tune this program in for the good people.
I hope you're good, because crime doesn't pay.
Via our wonderful McGee machine.
Yes. This one is waver on this part of the dial with this latch pressed just ever so slightly.
There we go. All right. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. This is The Dancing Hands from Saturday, March 19, 1949, originally over CBS.
They were born at the same hour on the same day of the same parents. And they were identical in beauty and talent. Only one was deadly, but the other was not. And I couldn't tell which was which until I found a green purse, a fresh corpse, and a pair of dancing hands.
From the pen of Raymond Chandler, outstanding author of crime fiction, comes his most famous character as CBS presents... The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. Now, with Gerald Moore, starred as Philip Marlowe, we bring you tonight's exciting story, The Dancing Hands.
The telegram I found stuck in the mail slot when I got back to my office after a long and roundabout day read, "Enclosed find a $50 money order. I want you to investigate a man. A table is reserved for you at the Saddle Club where I work. Come in time for the second show at 11, important." It was signed Beth Tyler. So at a quarter to 11, with 50 bucks worth of inspiration behind me, I drove over the Cahuenga Freeway and out Ventura to the Saddle Club, which pretended to be Old English by showing its beams through a flagstone facade. I went in the carefully rough-hewn oak door, and even before my eyes became adjusted to the cozy lack of candle power inside, Neil Redmond, owner and operator of the place, glided toward me, sporting his genial host smile, which tonight was even more forced than usual.
How are you, Marlo? It's been a long time. Business a pleasure, Phil.
It's always a pleasure to come to the Saddle Club, Neil. I've even got a reservation.
You know my food better than that, Marlo.
Uh-huh.
Just don't let it get rough, will you? Come on, I'll find your table out front. I want you to see this show. A pair of twins and a twin piano act that's sensational.
Yeah?
Edie and Beth Tyler. Oh, here, how's this?
Fine.
Incidentally, Edie will be the one on the left.
Well, if they're twins, what's the difference?
Plenty. Edie may be Mrs. Redmond one of these days.
Well, oh. Mrs. Redmond, but you are wanted on the phone, sir.
Get the number, George, and I'll call back.
This gentleman said you would talk to him, sir. It is Mr. Paul Cedar.
Paul Cedar? Oh, excuse me, Marlowe. This is important.
Redmond reacted to the name Cedar like a punch in the nose. But I figured that was none of my business, which was more than I could say for a flabby, dull-faced character at the next table, who followed the nightclub owner all the way out of the room with a pair of watery red eyes, which he deliberately avoided turning in my direction. But at that point, an MC stepped out on the stage, and so I stopped worrying about flabby in favor of the first look at my client.
The Saddle Club is proud to present its second show of the evening, featuring the incomparable piano stylist Edie and Beth in Dancing Hands. Here they are, ladies and gentlemen. Bring them up.
Curtains parted on the stage, set with an oversized full-length mirror, which reflected a grand piano, a black vase of yellow flowers, and a tall brunette with a wry, crisp waistline, who touched up a piled-high hairdo, put on a pair of long black gloves, checked her hemline, and sat down at the piano. And she ran through an involved arpeggio while her reflection in the mirror looked on in admiration. It was an old but cute routine, and the illusion was perfect because the Tyler twins were practically identical. I took another look at Flabby, whose face was pushed up in a nasty leer. He stood up, dropped his cigarette into his drink, and tossed a crumpled bill down on the table, just as the lights went out for the trick part of the act. On the dark stage, two pairs of purple hands danced over two glowing silver keyboards. It would have been good, except that the pair of hands on the right, which belonged to Beth, suddenly stopped in midair and hit blue notes like a 9-year-old at her first recital. When the lights came up again, my client's face was as white as Middle Sea, and the flabby character, oozing a victorious smile, was on his way to the door. Well, they wrapped it up fast after that, and Beth ran into the wings, leaving Edie to take the bow alone. The band took over in a hurry and brought things down to normal. So as couples moved down to the dance floor and George the waiter headed for my table, I sat back and waited for that message from my client.
Here you are, sir. Compliments of the house.
Oh, thanks. Any message with this?
No, sir. Just that Mr. Redman had to leave.
Oh, thanks, George. I sipped the double scotch and wondered if I should take the initiative and contact my client. When the message I'd been waiting for came, good and loud, I jumped up, shoved my way through the gaping dancers to the dressing room hallway behind the stage. A gang of club personnel was bunched in front of a door, obviously locked, labeled Edie and Beth Tyler.
Hey, it was one of the twins, buddy.
Hey, what's the matter?
It's one of the twins. She screamed. We gotta get in. That door's locked.
Break it down.
But
get out of the way.
It's Edie.
Wait a minute. Hold it. She's all right. Clear out and give her a chance. Come on. Outside, everybody. Beat it. That means you too. Come on. Out. Here, Miss Tyler, take it easy. You're all right now. Come on, sit down. Tell me what happened.
I don't know for sure. I was worried about Beth. I came back and didn't see her anywhere. Then I heard a noise in here. It was dark. I came in and someone grabbed me.
A man?
Yes. I don't know who it was.
Mm-hmm.
I screamed. He knocked me down. Then locked the door. Got out through the window there. Who are you?
Oh, I'm Philip Marlowe, a private detective. Your sister hired me to investigate a guy. I was to meet her here after your number and find out about it. Any idea what's up?
No, I can't imagine. But gee, Beth has been terribly upset ever since last night.
Oh? What happened last night?
Well, for one thing, my purse was stolen.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't see why that should upset her. Gee, there was nothing in it but $12 and my makeup stuff.
Where's Beth now, do you know?
No. I haven't seen her since she ran off the stage. I'm not even sure she came in here.
No, she was here, all right. She dropped one of her gloves. You're still wearing both of yours. Where do you girls live? Maybe she went home.
Well, Beth has a cottage out on Hazeltine. 4179.
You don't live together? How come?
Well, gee, Mr. Marlowe, just working with Beth is hard enough. She's so sarcastic.
Okay, I'll wear my thick skin. One more thing, Miss Tyler. Do you happen to know where Neil went?
Neil's gone?
Mm-hmm.
Gee, that's funny. He always stays till the place closes. Oh, he must be coming right back.
I'll take a look. Then I'm going out to see your sister. Sarcasm and all. I spent 10 minutes questioning the help on the whereabouts of the boss and got nothing but double talk for answers. So since I was still carrying Beth's glove around with me, I dropped it in my pocket and went outside to my car. I'd opened the door and slid far enough under the wheel so I couldn't back out before I realized that the dull-faced flab was already there on the seat. His right hand wrapped around something blunt and menacing in his sloppy jacket pocket.
You better come on in.
What are you doing in my car, blubber boy?
Don't get sassy now, mister. And the name is Sippy.
That's no improvement, that's no answer.
All right. I saw you inside making with the big talk, so I says to myself, he's an interested party. I should look him up. Maybe we can do business together. All right, stay over there.
What kind of business? I'm particular about the gutters I crawl in.
It has to do with the twins inside there. You can get in touch with me later for further details. I got an angle, mister. You'll see when I leave.
Yeah? When you tried to work that angle, you got to the wrong twin in the dressing room. Do you know that?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Sippy, where can I reach you?
You'll find out if you really know what's up. Don't try to follow me, though. I'll be seeing you.
When Sippy slid out of the car and beat it, I made one move after him and then stopped cold. Because lying on the seat where he'd been sitting was a green leather handbag with the name Edie etched on it. I snapped it open. It had been stripped of everything but the scent of Amir and a smudged slip of paper that read, No. 9 Arrow Motel, Lancashire Boulevard. So that was Sippy's address, and he had the stolen purse. But the why of all the commotion over 12 missing bucks was still the number one question mark. And I figured the best place for an answer to it was at Beth Tyler's. So I drove out to Hazeltine. But even before I stopped at number 4179, I heard the piano. I walked to the door and stood there a moment listening. I eased it open, slipped inside. Soft, indirect lighting accented the figure of a girl at the piano. The little waves of iridescent crimson chased themselves over the smooth satin gown as she played. Glossy, blue-black hair fell to her shoulders. Beside her, a burning cigarette sent a single plume of smoke into the still air. Just for a moment, I found it difficult to remember that she was my client.
Oh?
You're looking better, Beth.
You're Philip Marlowe, I suppose?
Yeah. I dropped by to return your glove, among other things.
Just put it there on the table with the other one. Where did you get it, Marlowe?
In your dressing room at the club. Your sister tangled with an unidentified man who was hiding there after you left. While we were on that, why'd you shove off so fast?
I was scared.
How'd you know I'd find you?
You're a detective, remember?
Mm-hmm. Look, if you want to burn up your retainer playing hide-and-seek, it's your business. Now, who's the guy you want me to check on? The flabby one who made you blow up tonight?
Yeah, Yeah, that's right.
Why?
Because I think my sweet twin sister is mixed up in something a little more serious than her usual scatterbrain escapades.
Hmm. And the flabby guy is in on it because he has a green purse, right?
How did you know that?
He left it with me. Name is Sippy. He lives at the Arrow Motel, number 9. Knows something worthwhile about this business, and he's anxious to sell it. All of which puts him a hop, skip, and a jump ahead of your detective. Now tell me, why is everybody, including Neil Redmond, all wound up over one stolen purse? What's it all about, baby?
I don't know, baby. Suppose you find out and tell me.
Wouldn't have anything to do with the fact that Neil loves your sister and you love Neil, would it?
Marlowe, I hired you to investigate a man, not to pry into my personal affairs.
You'll get more for your money if you stop holding out on me.
It's my money. Besides, I'm not holding out. Believe me.
I'll try. Real hard. Well, as soon as I've got something, I'll call you.
Where are you going now? My retainer entitles me to know, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. First to the club to find Redmond and get his side of it, and then I'll probably drop in on our chum, Sippy, at the Arrow Motel on Lancashire.
Good. I'll keep a light in the window for you.
Oh, sweet. Also keep your door locked. From the inside, baby. As I drove down the dark, winding street toward Ventura Boulevard, I caught a flash in the rearview mirror of a station wagon behind me. It looked like a tail, so I opened up, but it stayed with me. When it swung out into the left lane to pass, it suddenly cut in front of me. I jammed on the brakes as the spotlight slashed at my eyes, and when my front wheel banged against the curb, I was already half out of the car.
Stop right where you are, fella. Don't come 1 inch closer, I'll drop you.
I switched off the spotlight and I saw a face the texture of a doormat over an embroidered purple shirt and orange tie. He had hand-tooled high-heeled boots on and was topped off by a 10-quart cream-colored Stetson. But the doormat face was grim and the silver-barreled Colt pistol in his hand looked right at home.
I followed you up here from the Saddle Club. I don't know what your game is or why you're messing around and what don't concern you, but I aim to find out mighty quick, so start talking.
Okay, first I resent being crowded off the road. Second, I resent a spotlight in my face. And third, I don't like pistols pointed at my stomach. So cool off, Jesse James. You're wasting your time and mine.
You got it wrong there, friend. Paul Cedar don't waste his time, and you're going to find that out.
Paul Cedar, huh?
Yeah.
Don't tell me you're all excited over a stolen purse with $12 in it.
$12?
Yeah.
Listen, clown, there's 30 grand missing somewhere between Redmond and me, and I'm going to get it.
30,000?
Yeah. Redmond's a high roller, and that's okay with me. But he lost it fair and square in my joint over in Nevada, and I've been holding his markers much too long. So if I have to chalk that dough off to experience, it's going to be a pretty unpleasant experience for a certain party. Get me?
Yeah, I get you. But you're shoving the wrong way, Longhorn.
Somebody's trying to make a fool out of me, bright boy, and I don't stand for that. I'm liable to shove a lot of ways, and hard. So don't get underfoot, or you're sure to get stepped on. So long, dude.
In just a moment, we'll return to the second act of The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. But first, tomorrow marks the anniversary of an important event in American history, the signing of the first peace treaty between the Indians and the Plymouth colonists. In commemoration of these events, CBS's Sunday Night stars, Amos and Andy, will be found with a kingfish burying the hatchet deeper than ever in their hopes and dreams. And CBS's own Jack Benny will be back again tomorrow with his special guest, Van Johnson. Invite some friends over. Sit back and enjoy the Jack Benny program. You can hear Amos and Andy every Sunday on most of these same CBS network stations, and Jack Benny over them all. Now, with our star, Gerald Moore, we return to the second act of Philip Marlowe and tonight's story, The Dancing Hands.
When the Texan from Nevada galloped off in his trusty station wagon, I forgot all about Neil Redmond and headed instead for Sippy and his further details at the Arrow Motel on Lancashire, where Bungalow 9 turned out to be an all-alone green and white collection of clapboard that showed light, a half-open door, and nobody home to my knock. When I tried knuckles on wood again and still got only a faint echo for reply, I stepped inside. There in the center of an ivory-white throw rug and clamoring for attention like an only child at a family reunion was a wide and wet circle of red. From there, the ugly splotches that narrowed as they got farther away trailed off until, finally, in the next room, the path ended where I expected it to. The quiet form of Skippy, sprawled over an upset chair and holding his hands tight against the red on his left side. When I got to him, he was going fast.
$30,000. A lot of dough. Didn't know I was shooting that high. And the twins.
What, Sippy?
One of them.
Did one of them do this?
He's dead, isn't he, Marlowe?
Yeah. Yeah, Redmond, he's very dead.
Oh, no, Marlowe. I only found him a few seconds before you did.
Yeah, and the rest of that run, you heard someone coming. You didn't want to be seen, so you ducked back out of sight, huh? I don't buy it, Redmond, because for one thing, it's too pat. For another, how do you explain being here in the first place? Come on, fast.
Okay, I'm here because I'm in a nasty jam.
Like what?
Like $30,000 I've got to pay in the next hour to a guy named Paul Cedar who's running out of patience in a hurry, believe me.
About that I do. I've already met the gentleman. But right now, Redmond, we're talking about Sippy.
Okay. Last night, I had things to do, so I gave Edie Tyler the money for the payoff to Cedar. A couple of minutes after she stepped out of the club, somebody roughed her up and got away with a purse and the $30,000.
You're a liar, Redmond. Edie herself told me that purse only had 12 bucks in it. How come?
Simple like, Marlowe. In my business, you never yell copper too soon or too loud. It doesn't pay.
Mm-hmm. Now look, for the third time, Redmond, you and Sippy, how do you figure?
I don't know. He was at the club tonight, acting funny. When he left, I got a glimpse of Edie's green purse sticking out of his topcoat pocket. Later on, I saw him run away from the car near the club, so I followed. I ended up here a couple of minutes behind him, and that, Marlowe, was the truth, I swear.
Would you do at the drop of a... Hey, wait a minute. Look, if you're telling the truth, I begin to get a different picture. And by that, I specifically mean a very talented but very sly dame named Beth Tyler.
Oh, no, Marlowe.
Why not? Because you love Beth's sister? Face it, Redmond, it doesn't add up any other way. Sippy here couldn't have stolen that purse from Edie. If he did, he'd have taken his dough and blown, not spent his time putting out feelers. But on the other hand, if Sippy happened to see Beth take it from Edie, empty it and toss it away, we've got another story, right?
Yeah. Because he wouldn't make a move until he knew how much she had gotten away with.
Exactly. But there, he ran into trouble because he was trying to get close to Beth. And in doing that, he got mixed up and went for Edie instead, like tonight at the club.
Sure. And a dying man's words just now about one twin.
To which you can add the unpleasant fact that I personally ran off at the mouth when I was up at Beth's an hour ago. So she knew where to come for Sippy. Look, Redmond, it's got to run that way. I'm sure of it.
Well, maybe you're right, Phil, but right or wrong, I'm still in a jam. So if you don't have any objections, I'm going back to my club now for a last try at raising that money again before Cedar shows.
You mean you're going to face him, Neil, with or without
him? I've got him, Marlowe. You see, I own a fast club, all right, and I gamble a lot, too. But I don't welch on my markers, no more than I knock over flabby little guys. You know what I mean, Phil?
I think so. But don't fold now, Neil, because I might still be lucky enough to catch up to Beth Tyler and your money both before your time runs out. And right now that means fast to a phone and a call to Edie, who might know which way a runaway twin would head. I'll see you, Neil. Phone was at an all-night mobile gas station a block away. As I dialed Edie's number, a thought hit me. Maybe Beth wouldn't head anywhere. Maybe she'd just stick around.
Hello?
Edie, this is Marlowe. Seen anything of Beth?
No, I haven't. But why? What is it, Marlowe?
Well, from where I stand, two things. First, your sister has the $30,000 and $12 that was in your purse last night.
Oh?
And second, she's just about it for a sloppy around-the-edges murder. Now, look, have you any idea where Beth would head if she had to get out of town in a hurry?
No, I don't, Marlowe.
Oh, well, maybe somebody up around her place does. I'll call you later.
Marlowe, wait. Are you sold on this? I mean, about the things you said Beth did?
Just about, Edie. But for your sake, let's hope I'm wrong. All the way, honey. Goodbye. Driving fast back toward Beth's place on Hazeltine still left me enough time to think about a not-too-small detail that I'd completely overlooked. Thanks to me, the entire Los Angeles Police Department knew nothing about what was going on in and around the Saddle Club. 5 minutes later, when I'd parked away from the dock and obviously deserted number 4179, I'd walked back and around to a pair of uncurtained French doors at the side. I knew that oversight is what is generally called a blunder. But in the next second, I knew it was nothing compared to the one I was making currently.
If you so much as turn your head again, Marlowe, I'll kill you.
Not like you did Sippy, please, Beth. I'd hate to go that way.
Sippy was a mistake, Marlowe. Believe me. I was rushed.
So you shot and ran, huh?
Yes. But I didn't run too far, because from where I stood, I could hear and see both you and Redmond and talking the whole thing over.
And when you knew that we'd caught onto your act, you decided to follow me and see where I was going before you made your next move. Is that it?
Exactly. Now get inside. Go on, the door's unlocked.
Mm.
All right. Now get over there, near that closet, and don't turn around.
Why not? Afraid of the look on my face when you shoot?
Shut up, Marlowe. And stop being brave, because unless I have to, I'm not going to kill you. After all, you've already served your purpose.
Which I presume was getting mixed up in this mess just long enough to find out about Sippy for you.
You presume correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Also, you talk too much. Now open that closet and get inside.
All right.
Go on.
As you say. But first, baby, one question. Did you do all this for the 30 grand alone? Or does it tie in with Neil Redmond and the way he feels about your sister, Edie?
It's a little bit of each, Marlowe. But as I said, you talk too much. So get in there and shut up.
Getting out of Beth Taylor's half-inch thick oak closet was like arguing with an umpire. You couldn't be subtle. So 20 tiring minutes went by and the heels on both my feet were numb before the paneling finally gave in and I was out and over to the telephone to put in a call to the police. It should have been made a long time ago. But then, even as I was halfway through dialing the numbers, I saw something on an end table nearby that made me slowly change my mind. It was the two black gloves that Beth wore in the Dancing Hands act. And while I stared at them like they were alive and beckoning, I thought hard for what must have been a full minute. And then suddenly I knew that my next stop had to be the Saddle Club. As I parked at the Saddle Club, I saw a light drifting out of Neil's office, which was something I had expected. Inside, I moved along a dark hall toward what I knew would be the trio of Neil Redmond, the Nevada Texan, and Eddie Tyler.
All right, Redmond.
The raucous voice of Paul Cedar was anything but happy.
Just how stupid do you think I am? Oh, Cedar, I'm telling the truth. Edie had the 30 grand, but somebody got it from her when she was on her way to you.
That's a stinking line. You know it, Redmond. You never had the money. This whole thing's been a frame to stall me. And one way or another, I'm going to get you to admit that.
No, you're not, Cedar. And if you don't drop that gun now, you're never going to do anything, ever. Come on, let it go. All right. Now sit down and shut up and listen hard, because Redmond's telling you the truth.
What?
Marlowe, you know where the money is?
That's right. And I also know who took it. Less than an hour ago, a little after I called you, Edie, Beth caught up to me and confessed the whole shebang, exactly as we figured it, Neil.
You mean she admitted getting the money from Edie and using you to locate Sippy?
That's right. But there's only one drawback to everything she admitted. None of it's true.
What do you mean, Marlowe?
I mean, Cedar, that Beth Tyler didn't steal your money from Edie here any more than she killed Sippy. I also mean that, as far as I can tell, Beth Tyler was nothing more than a girl who played the piano and got upset when a stranger named Sippy started to bother her. And I never saw the real Beth Tyler after she ran away from a piano in the club tonight. That she's dead and that you, Edie, have been posing as Beth all night because, one, you yourself stole Neil's money, and two, you murdered your sister as well.
No!
Yes, Edie, come on, admit it, it's true.
No, it isn't. I guess it isn't that, Marlowe.
In Beth's body?
In our dressing room. In the closet. I didn't want to kill her. But she found out that I had only pretended to be robbed when there was no one around. That Sippy had seen me scream and get rid of the purse myself.
Sippy, who was only trying to muscle in on a deal, went to her by mistake, huh?
Yes. That's how she knew what I'd done. When she confronted me in the dressing room just before you came in and said that she wouldn't stand by and let me do a thing like that to Neil, I lost my temper.
You killed her, Edie.
Yes, I did, Neil. And when Marlowe showed up after her scream, I said that someone had attacked me. And then I pretended to be both Beth and myself from there on to get out of the whole thing. And I almost did. But now I'm so sorry.
A couple of bad hours went by before the police had everybody's story, and Paul Cedar and the 30,000 was gone for Nevada, and Edie was gone for good. That left just Neil Redmond and me alone and standing near the main bar in the club. Neil was doing his best to stay all in one piece.
Well, Marlowe, it's been a tough night for you, hasn't it?
Yeah, but a tougher one for you, Neil. What with Cedar and the money and...
The girls, Marlowe?
Yeah.
Yeah. At least it came out right before the cowboy got too tough, thanks to you. So tell me, Phil, how'd you know that Beth was dead and that Edie was both people all along?
That was a couple of gloves, Neil, the ones they wore in that dancing hands act. You see, when I first met Edie in the dressing room, she was wearing hers, and one of Beth's was on the floor. Hey, pawn me one, will you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I took it, and later when I met what I thought was Beth, I returned it, and she put it with what we both thought was its mate.
Hey, yeah.
Thanks. But a little while ago, when I got close to the gloves again, I saw that that couldn't be, that they were both for the left hand, Neil.
Ah. Then when Edie went to Beth's place to pass herself off as her sister, who she had already killed, she was smart enough to know that she should have only one glove around.
Yeah, but not smart enough to think about which glove it should be. From there, I worked backwards.
Until you got to the three of us at the club and tried what you knew might be the right answer.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you were right, Phil, all the way.
Yeah, but I was still gambling. If I had been wrong, Neil, I was giving the real Beth a long head start.
It's always that way when you gamble, Phil. I know. Sometimes you pick right, sometimes wrong. Mm-hmm. Cards, dice. Even with twins. Good night, fella.
When I finally got to my car, started out of the valley and back toward Hollywood, it was better than 8 o'clock in the morning. And here and there as I drove, I saw people who I'd never heard of and who'd never heard of me, stumbling outside after their morning papers. And I got to wondering what they were going to think when they read about a girl who had killed both a twin sister in a nightclub and a flabby guy in a motel who wasn't much good. Well, it was hard to say. And for myself, I was too tired to think. Or maybe I just didn't want to.
The Adventures of Philip Marlowe, created by Raymond Chandler, star Gerald Moore, and are produced and directed by Norman MacDonald. Script is by Mel Donnelly, Robert Mitchell, and Gene Levitt. Featured in the cast were Vivi Janis, Lou Krugman, Ed Begley, Paul Fries, and Bert Holland. The special music is by Richard Arant. Be sure and be with us again next week when Philip Marlowe says...
When it started, it was simple. Just a lawsuit for damages. But before it was over, it was far from simple, and the damages were murder. All because of a red-headed woman, a ghostwriter with ambition and a match that burned with a bright green flame.
With part of its star-studded Sunday nights devoted to shows named after great personalities such as Jack Benny, Lum and Abner, and Amos and Andy, CBS also goes to famous fiction for one of the brightest, most dramatic of its Sunday galaxy, The Adventures of Sam Spade. Created by the master hand of Dashiell Hammett, Sam Spade cuts a new and deadly caper with mystery, murder, and adventure on most of these same CBS network stations every Sunday. Join him tomorrow night. This is Roy Rowan speaking. Now, stay tuned for Gangbusters, which follows immediately over most of these same CBS stations. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
This is Fred Foy. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And we're back with you. I'm Big John, that's Steve. And you're listening to episode Pod 91 of The Glowing Dial, where we celebrate Father's Day and are presenting another tribute to those adventurous detectives.
Watching the detectives. Elvis Costello. Remember that song, John?
No, I don't.
Oh, yeah, that was a popular song for a while, back in the late 70s. Watching the detectives.
We just heard, folks, an episode of The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. That was The Dancing Hands from Saturday, March 19, 1949, originally over CBS. We have two more detectives to bring to you here. This salute to the adventurous fellows. But right now we have more celebrity birthdays to bring.
Who is in this next set? You never know.
June 19th, 1908, Miss Mildred Natwick.
Oh, I know her.
From Baltimore, Maryland. She was an actress in starring Boris Karloff, Best Plays, The Campbell Playhouse, and with Helen Hayes, they were the Snoop Sisters.
Snoop Sisters. She was one of the Snoop Sisters.
On
yes.
TV, that was part yes. of the NBC mystery movie.
Like those ladies.
That opened with the guy with the flashlight walking along to Ferranti and Teicher's music.
Mickey.
Which was it done electronically, I think.
Mickey.
Or part of it.
That's the name of the song, Mickey.
Mickey, is it
Mickey,
really?
M-I-C-K-E-Y, Mickey.
Oh, okay.
That went up. Yeah.
I never knew the title
Mickey,
of it. There's
yeah. a name for it, yep.
Alrighty then. Moving on. June the 20th, 1931. Another one of my favorite actors, Mr. Martin Landau. From Brooklyn, New York. He was an actor. On radio, he did No Love Lost. And on film, he was in North by Northwest. He was in a few Twilight Zones, Outer Limits, in those days, the early 60s. And, of course, he's probably well-known to the TV audience for Mission Impossible and Space 1999, where he was Commander Koenig on Moonbase Alpha.
Oh, yes.
June 21st, 1911, Irving Fine, born in Brooklyn, New York. He was a producer of the Jack Benny program.
Fine job he did.
Yes, he did. Oh. And, of course, don't know Jack and his cast were no slouches either. The writers, Jack just had everything going for him on that program. That's why Jack's the number one top of my list of favorite people. June 22nd, 1916, Johnny Jacobs. I know Steve knows that name.
Mm-hmm.
Milwaukee, Wisconsin is his place of birth. He was an announcer for Yours Truly, Johnny Dollar, Frontier Gentleman, and Granby's Green Acres, as well as some TV game shows.
Yes.
I don't know which one offhand now.
Doesn't he do Jeopardy? Is he the announcer, or is that Johnny Gilbert?
You know, I don't know. I remember Art Fleming was the host of Jeopardy originally.
Right.
Sorry, Johnny, I'm not remembering it. I should have put that down here, but I neglected to.
I believe he's still with us, too. No death date, is there?
1982,
okay.
Yeah.
Johnny Gilbert must be the one I'm thinking of then.
And, yeah, June 23rd, 1908, Miss Mary Livingston, also known as Sadie Marks, that was her real name, from Vancouver, Canada. She was a comedian and the wife of Jack Benny. She appeared on the Jack Benny program. And for a lady who had Mike Fright, she was just awesome. I mean, it's very sad that she had to have that limitation, but she needs... If I met her, I would tell her that she was just so utterly awesome that, you know, it didn't matter to us. But she had great delivery, great timing. She could put Jack in his place so easily. You know, Jack would say, well, but I think, and she would say, oh, shut up. Get a great roar from the audience. She could sing, too. She did a few times on the show. I remember she did Goody Goody. And a few other things. That's it for the celebrity birthdays this time around. One more set coming up toward the end of the show, and then we'll tell you how you can find out who you share your birthday with, which famous people. Like me and Albert Einstein. I was born on Pi Day.
Pi Day, that's right.
The value of pi is 3.14.
3.14 is your day, yep.
People just go out and buy pies, you know. Nobody gave me one in the face, though.
Yes.
I think there's
some radio pioneers. Now, when I think of pioneer, I think of Soupy Sales. Because he got pie in his ear.
Well, you got a pie in the face some years ago, didn't you?
I was a victim of a roast, and I got a pie in the face, is right.
Yeah. Who would do that to you, Steve?
You.
Oh. And you know what? It was one of the most satisfying moments of my life.
Kathy Kornshaw's jaw just dropped.
Oh, my God. Yeah, that was perfect. I hope we've got that videotape somewhere still. The sound didn't come out so good because, you know, but Her jaw just drunk. Nobody could believe what I did. I had to let Steve in on it, though. He knew it was coming.
Uh-huh.
But he pretended he didn't. To push a pie in somebody's face is one of the most satisfying things you will ever do as a human being in the corporeal world. You know what I mean? It's, do it by all means. Have yourself a Three Stooges pie fight. Just, you know, hire professionals to come in and clean it up afterwards. All right, Steve, it's time for our next program, our next detective. We're going to present the adventures of Sam Spade, detective.
This didn't mean he liked to play cards either.
No, I don't know.
Sam Spade, no. Or he didn't like shovels.
No, Sam Shovel was Lou Costello's parody of Sam Spade. Yes.
Right, yeah.
And those are very funny.
So it shows you how popular it was if they parodied it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Full of bad puns and jokes and everything. Just really funny stuff. So check out some of the later Abbott and Costello shows from the ABC run, I think. They did a lot of Sam Shovel parodies there. This one of Sam Spade is called The Caper Over My Dead Body. From Friday, November 17th, 1950, over NBC originally. And this stars Steve Dunn in the title role, along with Lorene Tuttle, Kathy Lewis, who at one time was the wife of Elliot Lewis, and Wally Mayer. Don Stanley is announcing, and the sponsor is Wild Root Cream Oil.
Wild Root Cream Oil. I wonder what the purpose of that product is.
Probably a tonic to make you look better in your
Maybe.
Head. You know.
It's sort of alluding, but like, okay.
Yeah. You take it every morning, and it helps the colon.
Like a Geritol or something, who knows.
Unless you've had part of it removed, then you only have a semicolon. But anyway... you have some information for us on the adventures of Sam Spade,
yes,
detective.
Here it is, the adventures of Sam Spade, colon, detective. Sam Spade was the creation of Dashiell Hammett, who, along with Raymond Chandler, godfathered the tough guy introspective school of detective fiction that got really big after the Second World War. Film star Howard Duff played Sam Spade. The role was also played by Steve Dunn at the very end of the show. Lorene Tuttle was Effie Perrine, his perfect secretary. Perfect fantasy of a private eye secretary, that is. And John McIntyre was Lieutenant Dundee. Later, William Conrad played Dundee when the production moved to Hollywood. William Spear, the great director of Suspense and many other fine shows, took the tough guy detective genre and shook it down to basics. Action, drama, toughs, dames, wisecracks, and laughs. Add great acting, and you have an excellent radio. Spade was meticulous enough to make a report on each case as it progressed, in line with Hammett's actual Pinkerton Detective Agency background. As the half-hour show unfolded, these reports were sent to Effie, too, so she always knew the score. It seemed she wanted to score with Sam, but that was a scratch at the track in his book. The caper always came first. The wisecrack came second. And if a tough it was unaccommodating, then an uppercut might be in order. Effie was there to take care of the business. John Dunning, in his On the Air, the Encyclopedia of Old-Time Radio, says, "The show was loved in its time and still is. The plots were often run-of-the-mill fare, obviously hacked out of the heat of the deadline. No one cared if holes were patched in an obvious and sometimes careless way. This show had a style and class that the others all envied. Duff made the writing part of his own unique character. The wit and charm of the show has weathered four decades, and The Adventures of Sam Spade remains today the pinnacle of radio private eye dramas." We can add two more decades in there, I'm sure, by now.
Uh-huh, yeah. All right, thank you, Stephen. And let us adjust the McGee machine and...
Lettuce! Sounds like a good salad in order. Oh,
now I'm kind of wanting a salad. I will see.
Mr. Salad.
Okay, got it right away. Got it right away. All right. Let's see if you've adjusted.
How about the show? Okay, that should do it. Coming in.
Sure is. All right, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember the adventures of Sam Spade Detective. This is The Caper Over My Dead Body, from Friday, November 17th, 1950, originally over NBC.
Response to requests representing millions of listening friends, the National Broadcasting Company is pleased indeed to bring you again The Adventures of Sam Spade, Detective.
Hello?
Me, sweet. What number have I got?
The Sam Spade Detective Agency.
Well, me, sweetheart.
Something's happened. Call me later, Dwight.
Dwight, yet. Look.
I didn't know you were in town. You didn't write to me or...
Effie, F.
Yes?
This is me in the flesh, Sammy the Spade.
Oh,
now what?
Goodbye.
Effie, I'm in a payphone. My nickel is running out.
Oh, Dwight, how can you be so cruel and play jokes at a time like this?
Wait, listen. Ella, you listening?
Yes.
I am not dead. Don't believe everything you read in the papers.
Huh?
Or hear on the radio.
Yes.
You were at my funeral. Is that what you were about to say?
Yes. And it was lovely.
Don't believe that either. Stay right where you are, sweetheart, because I'll be there, alive and handsomer than ever, with an account of a caper which proves you can kill some of the people part of the time. My exaggerated report on the death of Sam Spade.
NBC welcomes back to the air a character who has captured the public imagination more completely than any other since the birth of Sherlock Holmes. William Spear, radio's outstanding producer, director of mystery and crime drama, brings you the greatest private detective of them all in The Adventures of Sam Spade.
Ain't it grand to be blooming well dead? Candles at my feet, candles
I'm
at
sorry,
my head.
But we're not open for business today. I mean, Mr. Spade's office is closed right now because...
I'll wait.
Oh, you look just like Mr. Spade. What's your name?
Spade. S-P-A-D-E. Spade.
Sam never told me he had a twin brother.
He doesn't.
But then you...
I'm me, Sam.
Oh, no, you...
Oh, wait, come here. Now do you believe me?
Well, I don't know.
Oh, what's the use?
Oh, you're so much like him.
Oh, never mind. Now get your pencil and paper and take it. Date, November 17th, 1950. To Miss Effie Perrine.
That's me.
From Samuel Spade. That's me. License number 137596.
You must have been the last one to see him alive. Did he tell you to give me a message?
Shut up. Subject, my death. Dear Effie, since the sight of me in the flesh, breathing, hungering, and living doesn't convince you, maybe this report will. Think, if you can, back to last Monday. Now, if you recall, it was about 11 o'clock when, on the flimsy pretense that we needed stamps for the office, you drew $2 from petty cash and stepped out to buy a pair of step-ins. And that's when my client materialized. He was small and thin and carried with him the unmistakable odor of stale flowers. His black alpaca suit, string bow tie, elevator shoes, and white gloves had no bearing on his conversation.
Oh, dear. My name is Chester Swan.
Are you sure?
Yes.
My name is Spade. What can I do for you?
How tall are you, Mr. Spade?
6 feet in my feet.
Weight?
178.
I always notice a man's bone structure, don't you?
Oh, always.
Open.
Huh?
Open. Let me see inside.
Oh.
I guess.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Fine.
Oh, well, now that you know me this well, Mr. Swan, what can I do for you?
Oh, dear. Perhaps I shouldn't have come here at all. I'm sorry, Mr. Spade.
Well, really?
Oh, dear.
Oh, hello again, Mr. Swan. You wanted to talk to me?
Yes, but I can't talk now. Mr. Spade.
Still here.
There. I live at 8516 Claremont in Berkeley. I'll be there tonight. Oh, dear.
This time, as he made his exit, he left $50 on the edge of my desk. And so, stupid me, I was at 8516 Claremont at the close of the day. It was a small white cottage with green shutters and a white picket fence. There was a hill in back and a brook in front. The sun was beginning to set on it, and it was all very picturesque. In fact, so much so that a girl with red hair, blue jeans, purple smock, oils, and canvas was making it immortal. She liked me immediately.
Here, hold this.
Certainly.
Like it?
Oh, yeah.
This is my first landscape. I'm a sprouting artist.
Obvious. Makes your own?
Not when I can get somebody to do it for me. Who are you?
Oh, I might be a fellow artist.
Don't do that. You're a liar. You're Sam Spade. I saw your picture in a newspaper clipping when I was helping Chester clean out his desk before he moved it. You don't know an easel from a palette.
Oh, but I could learn.
I take it seriously.
Well, then so do I.
I doubt it. You've never tried to get away, to stand off, to throw off the shackles, have you?
No, I'll have to admit that the urgency of living, the pressure of merely existing, has had to...
Catfish, Sam. By the way, I'm Amy Goodrich.
Catfish?
The world is full of unhappy people who never try to get away from it all.
Well, honestly...
Stop it.
But I wanted to, really.
Honestly, Sam, get away from everything. Leave, dissolve.
I've dreamed of it.
Never return.
Cross my heart.
Mm-hmm. What are you doing here?
To see Mr. Swan.
He isn't home yet. His house is a wonderful subject. Look, Sam, colorful, moderate, pleasant.
Mm-hmm.
That is, until the sun stops shining. But picture it at night in the fog.
Mm-hmm.
Crushed with barrenness, full of death, brooding, ominous. I'm trying to capture that, too. It's what we've got to get away from, isn't it?
Absolutely. You and I...
Sam, as you start up the hill on Claremont, there's a green apartment house on the right. I'm in 420.
Well, maybe we'll find a way out together.
Maybe.
I waved her a fond farewell and sat on the steps of my client's house until he showed up at 6:15. He took me inside, where the only furniture was an army cot and a portable barbecue.
I'm so glad you kept our appointment, Mrs. Spade. I'm so frightened. I've been upset all week long. I didn't know what to do. I just didn't.
And what have you been so upset about, Mr. Swan?
Well, lately, Mr. Spade, infrequently, for the last week, I've noticed a man. I think he's following me.
Mm-hmm.
At first, I'd see him in a car following my bus when I went downtown.
Mm-hmm.
Then he'd be waiting around at the bus stop in the evening when I came back.
Oh.
I've sold my house, and I'm ready to move. It's unnerved me so much, but...
Did he follow you home tonight?
No, but
well,
I...
Well, would anyone be following you, Mr. Swan?
Well, I don't know, Mr. Spade. I don't know. I really don't.
All right, I'll try another tack. What does this man look like?
He always wears dark clothes and a hat. I'd say he was about your height.
6 feet.
I remember. Maybe heavier. Same bone structure, though.
Yeah. You haven't been to the police.
Oh, dear, no. A man in my business can't afford off-color publicity.
No? What kind of business is that?
The Bon Ton Mortuary.
Oh.
25 years.
Ooh.
Same location.
Ooh.
Oh, and I've worked hard. So very hard. And if there's something behind all this, something that has stopped me from being made the executive secretary of the Undertaker's Breakfast Club when they hold their annual election next month, I don't know what I'll do, Mr. Spade.
Hmm.
I just don't really know what I'll do. I just don't.
Oh, go ahead, Mr. Swan. You'll feel better. Just let it all out. Just really do. And he did. When he stopped crying, I instructed him to go about his daily habits as always and left, assuring him I'd get to the bottom of it all. I walked down to the corner ostentatiously, which is a neat trick well calculated to throw nefarious observers off the track and lull them into false security. And when the bus showed up 10 minutes later, I got on it, rode 3 blocks, walked back, and took a plant across the street. A clever ruse, as you see, to invite a showdown. 2 hours later, a man about my size and dark clothes appeared over the hill and crept stealthily to the front of my client's cottage. He had his eyes glued to the window when I walked up behind him.
Hey, let go of me.
Come on, you're going inside.
Listen, I'm no peeping Tom.
No, you're the bloodhound type. I'm inviting you in for a real sniff at
your
quarry.
Oh, no, you don't. Well, all right, then. I'll go quietly.
Okay, that's better. Now we'll just walk on. The kick he landed on me wasn't according to Queensberry. I couldn't move for 3 or 4 minutes, and by that time he disappeared. When I recovered my faculties, I reported the incident to my client, who cried himself to sleep. After I bolted him in for the night, I stopped on my way down the hill at apartment 420 in the little green apartment house. She was still wearing the blue jeans and the purple smock. And she still had the same ideas.
Come in, Sam. You said you were serious about getting away from it all, and a whole day has passed.
It was that pressure of living. I'm here to apologize.
Mm, you are not, but go ahead.
I'm sorry, Angel.
I love to be fooled, Sam. You're forgiven.
How's the painting coming? The one of Swan's cottage.
Slow. Fog is always tough.
Looks nice, though. How long you been on it?
3 weeks, all told.
Well, then you've had a pretty good plant on the house, haven't you? Ever notice a tall, broad-shouldered guy in a dark suit casing the place?
Tall, broad-shouldered?
Pretty much like me.
Could anybody be pretty much like you, Sam?
No, you're right.
Sam, is there something wrong?
No.
Well, then don't stand there doing nothing. Do something.
Who, me? Amy fixed me a small dinner, which had a strong turpentine taste to it. Then we mixed oils and painted and made fudge. Next afternoon, at the Hall of Records, I did a little spade work on Chester Swan. His application and permit to practice undertaking in the city of San Francisco were dated 1938. Details, unmarried, 52 years of age. Graduated from mortician school in Ohio. Listed one living relative, nephew, Theodore J. Swan, Toledo, Ohio. I was gathering the above information when I smelled whiskey over my shoulder, which is always good luck. It was Al Torrington, who was also in the private investigation racket in this city, and he was leaning, peering from my face to the card that I held in my hand.
Get over to you too, Sam?
Who got over to me, Al?
Him? That finny with the tears? What's his name? My eyes ain't so good.
Swan, Al. Chester Swan. Mortician.
Yeah, that's him, Sam. The same one exactly. Came to my office 2 weeks complaining about somebody following him. And he did nothing about it. Said I was too fat.
Oh, well, you are, Al. Are you sure?
Sure, I'm sure. And some other, the boy, said he was around there, too. Wanted a private eye, but he wanted a man who looked just right.
How right?
Obviously as right as you are, Sam, because it looks like he picked you. Yeah.
Yes, F, it did look like he picked me. And I thought that over, and I didn't like it. And I called my client at home to tell him he was fired, but he didn't give me a chance.
Oh, dear, I'm so glad you called, Mr. Spade. I really am.
I called for a reason, Mr. Swan. I'm resigning this case.
Oh, dear, Mr. Spade, you can't do that. You really can't.
I don't think you've been quite honest with me, Mr. Swan.
Oh, dear.
Tears will get you nowhere. I made a routine check on your reasons for hiring me, and they don't quite fit with the reasons you gave. They really just don't quite, Mr. Swan.
It's no game, Mr. Spade. Believe me, He's back tonight. Right now, he's standing beneath the lamppost outside my window, and I'm frightened to death. Mm. Please hurry over, Mr. Spade, and let's get this business straightened out. Please, please.
And stupid, stupid me, I went over. And I found that little white cottage on the hill looking grim and gaunt in the heavy fog. Amy's words about it being crushed with barrenness, full of brooding and death, came back to me. And Mr. Swan's frightened words about a mysterious man in dark clothes waiting beneath the streetlight also came back to me, particularly when I noted there was no streetlight near the house. However, there was a light somewhere in the rear of the house, and the front door was ajar. Oh, Mr. Swan! Mr. Swan, are you here? Oh, Mr. Swan, it's me, Sam Spade. Are you here?
Mr. Spade? Is that you? Are you out there?
Where are you? Things happened fast. I turned around to find the front door filled with a man in a dark suit. He had something in his hand. It looked like a roll of cotton candy, but it felt different. It only staggered me against the wall, but it made me forget where my arms were.
Easy, Spade. Easy does it, boy. Easy.
He let me down to the floor gently. I could still see the lights somewhere in the back of the house, and I could hear him talking way off.
Take off his coat. Quick. Give me the needle.
Hurry. I can't watch. I'm going upstairs.
The needle went somewhere in my left arm, but not before somebody pulled my coat off, and for no reason I could think of at the moment, also tried to pull my finger off. Well, I couldn't dwell on it. By that time, the stuff in my arm was going other places, and I was going with it, even though there was action all around me.
This ought to do it!
No, stay away from me! Get out of here!
Vaguely, somewhere, somebody was shooting Roman candles or having blowouts or playing bebop. I just didn't care at all. I just didn't. The first thing I saw was sunlight. It was the kind you see in a picture. It was a picture of a little white cottage with green shutters. You guessed it. I was in Amy's apartment, where we made fudge together. I got to my feet somehow.
Right here. I've had it here for 2 days. We'll have to figure
about the best thing to do with him.
I knew the best thing to do with me. There was a fire escape and a window. I got out there and I weaved against the wall.
He's gone! He's gone!
What do you mean he's gone? He couldn't have gotten away with that load he was carrying.
I don't know. He was unconscious when I left.
Well, don't just stand there. We've got to do something. There might be trouble. Now, let's get going.
I didn't wait to find out what they were going to do. I made my way down the fire escape and started walking for the street, and that's when I noticed my shoes didn't fit me anymore. They weren't mine. And neither was the gray flannel suit with the label marked Tidkeys. And neither was the blue shirt. And while I was at it, the ring on my finger engraved Emerson High 1936 wasn't mine either. My new belt buckle had a big letter T on it, which is not my initial. It really isn't. And I didn't have any use for the eyeglasses in my coat pocket either. You were out when I walked in the office, F, but you'd been there. There was a black crepe done up in a white satin ribbon hanging on the door. The desk blotter was drenched with salt tears, and a newspaper folded back to page 13, and I'll sue the Chronicle on this if it's the last thing I do, gave me a 2-inch spread. Item, November 15th, 1950. 15? What happened to the 13th and the 14th? Detective perishes in Berkeley fire. I read it through once, then twice. It was my obituary.
You are listening to the first in a new series of adventures involving radio's most famous detective, Sam Spade. Later tonight on most NBC stations, Duffy's Tavern comes your way with another merry half-hour session, starring Ed Gardner as Archie the manager. There's a full serving of laughs garnished with chuckles and whipped up by Archie and his unpredictable friends, Miss Duffy, Clifton Finnegan, and Eddie the waiter. It's just one of the many great Friday evening entertainment features on NBC. It's Duffy's Tavern, your cue for better listening where the three chimes always mean good times. Make it a Friday evening habit to tune early and stay late at your favorite NBC station. And now back to Caper Over My Dead Body, tonight's adventure with Sam Spade.
I left the crepe on the door and went out to buy a new desk blotter and some more newspapers. The Hobo News had the best story, which wasn't much. Samuel Spade, licensed private investigator, perished Wednesday night in a fire in a vacant house in Berkeley. His warm friends will feel regret at the passing of a man who was always kind to the poor. None of us ever asked Sam Spade for a handout without receiving a kind word and bon mot as he turned us down. This was nice, but I wanted more. Figured I was fairly safe to wander about unrecognized. My ill-fitting attire acquired from my unknown benefactor would be disguise enough when combined with my two-day beard. Engine Company 16, Berkeley Division, had handled the fire, and half a block away was a grog shop called the Shamrock. I waited for a fireman to come in.
Bartender! What kind of a place are you running now? I've been here 5 minutes already.
All right, shut up, Patty. You just arrived.
Well, it seemed like 5 minutes. A wee bit more there, if you don't mind.
That's enough for you, Patty. You're still on duty.
I am not. I'm off now. The chief said I could be off. It ain't every day I receive such a shock to me system.
You received your shock 3 days ago.
And I'm still shaking, man. Oh, the sight of him was terrible. Burnt as black as the good saint's beard. All twisted and horrible in death.
He was probably dead drunk and didn't know what happened to him.
And were you there fighting the flames and finding him like me? Oh, it was terrible. Terrible.
It wasn't that bad, and you've had your limit.
And who says so?
I say so.
Oh, you do, do you? And who are you?
Your brother-in-law.
Well, now.
Well, maybe I can spot you one, Pat.
I never drink with strangers. What's your name?
O'Doolan.
Well, you heard the man. Go ahead, pour. Cheers.
Yeah. Fireman, you had a terrible experience 3 days ago.
Oh, that I did, Mr. O'Doolan. That I did indeed, that I did.
I've heard it a dozen times. I'll be at the other end.
It was three nights ago, Mr. O'Doolan, and we get a call to the house on Claremont is afire.
Well, sir, when we get there, it's about all gone. Can't understand why it went up flames so fast.
Wood.
It was the funeral pyre of a man who lived in sin.
Huh?
A detective fellow. Sam Spade, he was identified as. Ooey.
Oh, one moment, fireman. I've heard fine things about him.
Ah, some of those uppity police fellows from the Division of Homicide says he was a nice fellow. But some of the boys at the fire station and myself, well, we got our own ideas about that.
What kind of ideas, Patty, my boy?
What kind of good can any man be accomplishing in an empty house late at night, I ask you, Mr. O'Doolan? Mm-hmm. Oh, he was done to a turn he was when I burst in the door with me axe. Save Satan the trouble.
Charred.
Empty whiskey bottles scattered all about. Sin, O'Doolan, sin. He'd gone to sleep with a smoking cigarette that set the whole place off. Vice rampant!
From there, I went downtown to a telegraph office where I sent a wire to Toledo on a long chance. And while I was waiting for an answer on a not-so-long chance, I slunk into the Bon Ton funeral parlor to pay my respects to the departed. I stood in the back of that dimly lit chapel and scanned the scene. Three of the boys from Homicide were there, blowing their noses. Two chorus girls I thought had long since forgotten me were there in black, deep V-necks. My insurance man was there, looking awful worried. One Chronicle reporter with photographer, and a shoeshine boy from our building, and the bailiff from the courthouse, just to mention a few I could make out. And you were there, Effie, up front near a closed casket. I made out a bower of flowers from robbery detail. It said, "Goodbye, Sam." Maxie from the city morgue was the only one who looked at ease.
All right. Does anyone wish to, you, miss?
Many called him Shaman. But I called him friend. On this, his last caper,
I was touched, Effie, and I would have stopped the whole thing then and there, but I had to find out who was in that casket. I reeled out the front door with tears in my eyes and slid around to the back door and into Chester Swan's private office. And there I made a phone call and got an answer to my telegram, which caused me to make another call to his bank. By that time, most of it was right in place. A search through his desk revealed nothing, and a safe standing in the corner the same. But then my answer walked right in the door.
Oh, Sam, darling, I was so worried when I found you'd left, but I saw you at the funeral and I thought you'd be here.
And the guy who was with you, was he worried too?
Oh, him. That was Dr. Jesslyn. Sam, you'd been out for 2 days and I didn't... Oh, Sam, you're safe. You got away from it all. You've escaped, darling.
Yeah, they're burying me right now. I'm dead.
It's so wonderful, Sam.
Only one thing. Where do you fit?
Hmm?
The caper. I was supposed to burn up in that fire and what was left was supposed to look enough like Theodore J. Swan, class of 1936 Toledo, Ohio, to let beneficiary Chester Swan collect a nice pile of insurance money.
Sam, what are you talking about? Who's Theodore J.? What did you say?
Chester's only living relative. They're burying him right now. Somebody lost his caper. You want to tell me?
Darling, I was at the house the night of the fire, working on my foggy picture. You didn't see me when you went in, and later on you didn't come out. And I went over...
And I was on the floor, and a man was bending over me.
He changed clothes with you, Sam, and I screamed, and he pulled out a gun, and I hit him with a hoe. And I drug you out on the lawn.
And then what happened?
I put you in my car and took you home. I was going to phone the police, but I decided it was something you were working on, and I went back to the house, and it...
And it was burning, and you knew the man you'd hit on the head was in there.
Believe me, Sam, I didn't know the house was going to burn down. I wouldn't kill anybody, Sam. I only wanted to...
You only wanted to help me, and you did right, Angel.
Oh, Sam.
It's all right. I'm your witness. You didn't start the fire.
You mean somebody really started it?
Chester. He thought it was me lying on the floor in there. The bank tells me he's about to go busted. He figured this one out with his nephew to scare up some insurance, though. I'm about the same
size.
Hold
me, Sam. Hold me. It's been horrible. This is the kind of thing I was trying to paint. Now I'm smack dab up against it and I'm sick. I'm scared.
Easy, easy.
Sam, you're really dead. There's our way out, Sam. Just leave now. Let it go the way it is. They all think you're dead.
Oh, dear.
Huh?
But we know different, don't we, Mr. Spade?
He was holding a Navy Colt revolver in front of him with both hands. I couldn't make up my mind to rush him and count on his bad aim or stand still and be a perfect target while I tried to talk him out of it. Either way, he was a crazy man with a gun, and he was getting ready to use it.
Sam, he's going to kill us.
Mr. Spade, because my nephew was stupid enough to wear your watch and your suit when he exchanged clothes with you, I'm going to lose the Bonton.
And that puts you in quite a spot, doesn't it, Mr. Swan?
Until a moment ago, yes, but now... Mr. Spade, the newspapers all say you're dead. A death certificate says the same thing. All of your friends are following your casket and my nephew's corpse to the cemetery at this very moment. Everybody expects you to be dead, Mr. Spade.
Thanks to you, Mr. Swan.
But now, nobody'd miss you if I killed you.
I'd miss you, Sam.
But I'd have to kill you, too.
Oh.
Did you notice you're still wearing Theodore's clothes, even his ring? Why, Mr. Spade... I could kill you and put you in a fire somewhere and collect my insurance on Theodore now, couldn't I?
No. Why, that's a terrible thing to think.
Huh?
Oh, you're not reasoning properly, Chester. You really aren't. How would you explain Amy? You just said you'd have to kill her. And what about the coroner's office? You know how they are.
But really...
Don't forget the medical examiner's got something to say, too. Not to mention the fact that you'd have to really burn me up to cover up the bullet hole. And furthermore, Chester, when you shoot me, if you happen to hit a rib and chip off some bone, they'd know I was shot before, and then homicide'd be in on it.
Oh, no, stop. Nothing works for me. I'm a failure.
Oh, go ahead, Mr. Swan. Let it all out. You'll feel better. And he did. And he's still crying in his cell downtown. Period. End of report.
Oh, Sam, you were so brave. You actually stood there and talked that crazy man out of murdering you. You were wonderful.
True, Effie? Amy thinks so, too. She's going to do me in oils when they let her out of the pokey.
Amy's in jail? What for, Sam?
Oh, technical charge of an involuntary manslaughter. They'll spring her as soon as the coroner's inquest is completed. Dear Amy.
Did she make good fudge, Sam?
Fudge? Oh, that was the least of it.
Oh? What do you mean?
After the fudge.
What then?
Panucci. Oh, boy, oh, boy. Say, go type that up, sweetheart, while I see if there's any mention of my miraculous resuscitation on the radio page. Go. Scoot.
There certainly is a mention of Sam Spade on the radio page for Friday. Sam Spade is one more in the list of great shows to join up in NBC's Parade of the Stars. Have you heard The Big Show? This Sunday, The Big Show comes your way once again on NBC. Listen to just a few of the star names who will be appearing this week. Bob Hope, Jimmy Durante, Perry Como, Jose Ferrer, Mindy Carson, Eddie Cantor, Meredith Wilson and his orchestra, and many, many more. And, of course, your MC once again will be the lady who invented the snappy retort, Tallulah Bankhead. Yes, it's The Big Show. It's big in music, big in drama, and big in comedy. Be sure to hear The Big Show Sunday.
Well, here it is, Sam. All typed up.
Good. I will sign it, and you will keep it, always, to remind you that I'm still here.
Oh, Sam.
Living, breathing, brave, and handsome. A paragon. Mm.
Sam, what will we do about the mail?
The mail? What mail? Where?
Well, all the letters and postcards and telegrams and all that came when people thought you... When they thought you were...
Oh, there have been enough tears tonight, Effie.
Oh, Sam, it's so good to have you back. Will you be the same as you always were?
Well, I'm going to try, Effie.
Because then you can't help but be, like they say, the greatest private detective of them all.
We'll see.
Good night, Sam.
Good night, sweetheart.
The Adventures of Sam Spade are produced, edited, and directed by William Spear. Sam Spade was played by Stephen Dunn. Lorene Tuttle is Effie. Script for tonight's adventure by E. Jack Newman. Musical scoring by Lud Gluskin, conducted by Frank Worth. Join us again next week, same time, for another Adventure with Sam Spade. Hear the Magnificent Montague, then visit Duffy's Tavern on NBC.
Good ladles, evening and gentlemen. This is Jay Ronburn inviting you to hear the Gliling Doe. I mean the Dueling Glile. Well, you know. It's the best in old raid timey-o with Big Ston and Jeeve. Don't Dutch that tile.
We are back with you. I'm Big John. That's Steve. And we are your hosts. You're listening to episode pod 91 of The Glowing Dial, where we celebrate Father's Day and are presenting another tribute to those adventurous detectives. We just heard from The Adventures of Sam Spade Detective. That was The Caper Over My Dead Body from Friday, November 17th, 1950, originally over NBC. Got one more detective to bring you in this tribute to those adventurous fellows. But first, we have the final segment of Celebrity Birthdays, and then we're going to tell you how you can find out who you share your birthday with.
Oh, right. You've got a good set here, John. Starting off June 24th in 1904, Phil Harris from Linton, Indiana was born. He was a band leader and singer. He was on the Jack Benny program and also his own Phil Harris Alice Faye show. Did voices for Disney. He was Baloo the Bear in The Jungle Book.
Oh, right, and he had a lot of great silly songs out there, like That's What I Like About the South, and
he did
Wouldn't
very
Spare
well,
That
too,
Tree,
yeah.
And Bump on the Head Brown, titles like that.
Hambone. I got a record from him, Hambone, a single.
Preacher Hambone, and the Bear.
Hambone, June the 25th, 1925, Miss June Lockhart was born in New York City to the famous Lockhart family. Her father was an actor, and then her daughter. So they have three generations of Lockhart.
Her daughter Anne and her father Gene.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Three generations of Lockharts.
And she was a classy lady. She's
yes,
a classy
very, very
lady.
Nice lady. She was in Lux Radio Theater, Suspense, and on television, Lassie and Lost in Space.
That's right.
And Petticoat Junction.
She took over for Bea Benaderet when Bea became too ill to go on with it. Yeah.
Then, next birthday, June 26th, 1904, Peter Lorre was born in, I'm going to try to pronounce it, as Rozsahegyi, Hungary. Actor, he was I.A. Moto in Mr. Moto. He was in Creeps by Night and Mystery in the Air.
Yeah, you want to hear the intensity that Peter could put into a part. Listen to Mystery in the Air. I mean, he like Agnes Moorehead, put everything they had and more into a part. I mean, Agnes, at the end of Sorry Wrong Number, they said that she, you know, was sweating and she just, you know, collapsed on the table because she threw all her energy into it. And Peter did, too. You kind of want to take a couple steps back if you were watching him, you know, because you're afraid he's going to lunge at you or something when he gets into those parts where he has to develop a rage, you know, against something. So, wonderful actor.
Next birthday, June 27th in 1912, Mr. Bill Kennedy from Cleveland Heights, Ohio was born. He was an announcer. He was in Nobody's Children. And we know him locally here in Detroit for his Bill Kennedy at the Movies program on Channel 9 and Channel 50.
It was on at 1 in the afternoon for 2 hours, I believe. And again, with his segments and everything, they had to butcher the films, so they were not uncut. But he would take phone calls from viewers. And I think I tried to call him once. Or maybe I wrote in a question or something like that. I couldn't think of anything to ask him. I'm a kid, you know.
Yeah. He had a fantastic collection file of movie photo stills of actors and actresses over the years. I'm like, wonderful collection. A lot of it. Very rare. June the 28th, 1914, his next birthday, Jan Seymour, born in New York City. He was an actor and narrator. He was Danny in Aunt Jenny's Real Life Stories, and he appeared in War of the Worlds.
He was the announcer, the first voice you hear in the Mercury Theater's War of the World, you know. The Columbia Broadcasting System and its affiliated stations coast to coast. That was him, and I believe that was him on the rooftop when the black smoke got him. You know, it's 100 yards away, 50 feet.
Yeah,
that was Dan Seymour. Yeah.
And the last birthday in the set, June 29th, 1901, Ed Gardner from Astoria, New York was born. He was a comedian. He was Archie in Duffy's Tavern.
Archie, or no, it's Duffy's Tavern where the elite meet the eat. Archie demands you're speaking. Duffy ain't here. That's how he answered the phone every time. Sometimes it would be Miss Duffy. It would be somebody different most of the times. But, okay, that was the celebrity birthdays. Now, those come to us by our good friend, Mr. Ron Sales. He's got a blog that has them for the entire year. So you can head over to that blog and see who you share your birthday with. You can get there by going to glowingdial.com. That's our main page. Menu on the left, just click on links, and Ron's link will be right up there at the top. And when you go over there and check out all his good work, you know, drop him an email, let him know what a good job he's doing and that you appreciate it, because we sure do. And tell him Big John and Steve from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there. And Ron, thank you, sir, for letting us use the information here on the Glowing Dial. It's a nice additional little feature that we do here just to give a little more spice to the show, and it gives us some things to talk about as some of the birthdays are the celebrities are prompt a little more discussion.
My birthday is the same as Christopher Knight from the Brady Bunch.
Oh, really?
Yes, he was Peter Brady.
Uh-huh, right, the middle. He's
2 years
child.
Older than I am, yes.
So when did your voice change?
Probably about the same time.
Time to change!
Yeah.
We have watched way too much TV, Steve. Way too much. Just wonder we had any kind of a normal life sitting in front of the
TV. I was the oldest child, and my parents had to take care of the younger one, so they put me in front of the TV, and I watched and watched and watched, and I watched a lot of different things.
You know, I was on YouTube recently, and I think I told you about this. I came across an uploader who somehow this person is getting all these clips, all these opening credit sequences from classic shows.
Oh, yeah. You were telling me about that.
And he arranges them, he or she, arranges them into, like, here's ABC's Fall 1966 lineup. And you play them and you watch them. Some I don't remember. Some it's like, oh, yeah, I had forgotten about that.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it's kind of an interesting trip. I don't remember the uploader's name, but just look for something like, you know, Fall 1966 TV show opens or something like that. That should bring it up for you. And those are just fascinating. I didn't realize how late it had gotten, and I had to get to bed to get up for work the next day, that I was just watching these things. And I'm saying, oh, Steve would eat this stuff up. He would say, oh, yes, I remember this one. Oh, no, I don't remember that one, but this one I do. And
yes, I'm a few years older, so I probably can remember a lot more. I could stay up a little bit later.
Right. You may have had another TV set to look at, too. I did not.
No, not until 1971.
Oh, yeah, me too. 72, I think I got my own.
Little portable TV set.
Little black and white. Yep. Mm-hmm. And if I was really lucky, I got to watch the opening to Lost in Space in color.
Mm.
Because Dad was not a man of imagination. Mm. Science fiction was not his thing at all.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very basic people, my folks. But anyway, enough about that. I think we've gotten the birthdays out of the way.
Yep.
It's time for our last program. It's going to be The Adventures of the Falcon.
Not the bird.
No.
Oh.
So we wouldn't call what he does falconry.
No.
That's working with birds of prey. That's what falconry is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We see that at the Renaissance Festival sometimes. It's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. They actually have a demonstration there. Somebody has a falcon, and they do things that the falcon was trained for.
And some of those birds are pretty big close up.
They're very fast.
The talons. They got these big protective things on their arms.
Because those talons are so sharp, they would really pierce you.
Well, that's how the bird gets its prey and hangs onto it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Great for chasing mice and other little undesirable rodents and things. But yes, they can be performed to do tricks.
I got to train my kitty to do rodents. We don't have a rodent problem right now, but my kitties, I don't know if they would run from them or challenge them.
Hmm.
Neko would probably run. Akuma would probably challenge. because she's a cute little girl, but she has claws. Anyway, The Adventures of the Falcon. This is called The Case of the Falling Star. It's from Thursday, May 15th, 1952, originally over NBC. And it stars Les Damon in the title role, and the show was sustained. That's all the cast information I've got on that, unfortunately.
Catch a falling star, but, ran, put it in your pocket. That was Perry Como.
Oh, Como. Falling Stars. That's right. That was my mom's favorite.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She also called him My Pair.
My Pair. Oh, yep. Perry Como. Yeah. I liked his Christmas shows. They were very entertaining. And he had different things on there every year. Mm-hmm. And they'd always introduce a brand new Christmas song each year.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no. I'm sure Mom was watching those every year.
Over the years, through the 60s and 70s, there'd be new Christmas songs coming out, and they introduced them on the program each year, a new Christmas song.
Perry had such a relaxed way of performing. Such a low energy, but a good voice. I mean, and people have made fun of him. You know, SCTV used to do parodies of a lot of celebrities. They did a parody of Connie Francis called Connie Franklin. You know, and just singing the most depressing songs ever, you know, and they had Perry, I think it was Dave Thomas or was it Rick Moranis that played Perry Como, and they had him, you know, singing in all these different, you know, in an easy chair and then in a bed all tucked up, and he was singing because he's so laid back. He can sing while in a bed or something, you know. Huh? They just made fun of that. But
they used Perry Como as the basis for the Sugar Bear character on the cereal box.
Did they really? I always thought that was more Dean Martin type.
No, that was Perry Como.
Because it was kind of a swing.
He's in a turtleneck.
Huh. Really?
Yeah.
Well, about the ant and the aardvark, the ant was definitely Dean Martin. Yeah. And the aardvark had to be Jackie Leonard, or Jackie Mason, one of the two. One of the Jackie's stand-up comics. Just by the voice. Anyway, okay, you have some information for us about the Falcon.
The Adventures of the Falcon, yes. The character of the Falcon was created by Michael Arlen in a 1940 story, Gay Falcon, which almost immediately became an RKO film and subsequently a movie series. The early Falcon films followed the Arlen story to this extent. The hero, played by George Sanders, was then named Gay Lawrence, using his Falcon identity in his dealings with the underworld. Sanders tired of the film role, and in The Falcon's Brother, RKO 1942, the character was killed on screen, leaving the Falcon's brother there after played by Sanders' brother, Tom Conway, to carry on. On the radio, the character's name was Michael Waring. Each show began with a telephone ringing. It was always a woman calling. Waring, whose smooth voice was laced with a hint of the British, usually addressed her as Angel or some other endearment. Inevitably, he had to beg out of a date using such excuses as, "I've got to teach some gangsters that you can't get away with murder, especially since the murder they want to get away with is mine." This preceded the opening signature. Waring's methods crossed somewhat between Ellery Queen and Richard Diamond. He has a certain eye for detail, but was frequently on the outs with the cops. The police were usually portrayed as stumblebums, and Waring was quick to point out that in a snappy, sarcastic dialogue. Actors who portrayed the Falcon on radio were Barry Kroger, 1943, James Meehan, 1945-47, Les Tremaine, 1947-1950, Les Damon, 1950-1953, and George Petrie, 1953-54. During the Les Damon run, Waring worked for Army Intelligence, solving espionage crimes overseas.
All right, then. There you have it, folks, all the information that's fit to present on The Adventures of the Falcon. Time now to tune in the episode for you.
And the Falcon would be over at the middle portion of this dial. Flip this switch here, and this one.
The Mickey machine just gave you the bird. All right, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember The Adventures of the Falcon. This is The Case of the Falling Star, from Thursday, May 15, 1952, originally over NBC.
Yes, this is the Falcon speaking. Oh, Doris. No, you'll have to include me out tonight. I've got to discuss an idea for a movie. No, I can't make it, Angel. No, I can't miss this. These characters have dreamed up the perfect switch. Instead of shooting pictures, they plan to shoot people.
Once again, the Adventures of the Falcon, dedicated to private investigators everywhere. Those hard-hitting detectives who, like Mike Waring, risk their lives to aid law enforcement agencies. So join him now when the Falcon solves The Case of the Falling Star.
It's Sunday afternoon in New York, and in his hotel suite, Ken Marlowe, who smashed his way to movie stardom by portraying a two-fisted drinking man, is giving a sample of the performance that made him famous.
Good.
Only this time, Ken isn't acting.
I'll fix them all. When I get through those crumbs, they'll know better than the horse. Yeah? Well, it's about time, fella.
That's what I thought, too.
Huh?
How are you, Ken?
Oh, Jackie Howard. I'm sorry, I was expecting somebody else.
I'll bet she's a lot prettier.
Nothing like that. I'm here with a wife. It's a funny thing, I didn't even know you were in town. I thought I left you on the West Coast.
Well, haven't you heard? Trailways runs all over the country. All you gotta do is buy a ticket.
Look, Jackie, I know what you want. I intended to clean up that 15 grand I owe you before I left.
It's 19.
Oh, 15, 19. What's the difference? I'm good for it.
Are you? Someone told me you washed up at National Pictures.
They're crazy. I'm in like Flynn.
Well, I'm glad to hear it. Of course, if they don't pick up your option, you see my position. As I said, you're into me for 19 grand.
And as I said, I'm good for it. I can write my own ticket at any studio. Who is the number one box office draw on 49?
You?
Well, they are.
No, there you were. That was 49, Ken. 3 years is like 300 in Hollywood.
Look, I tell you, you got nothing to worry about. National will pick up my option on the 23rd.
And when can I expect you to pick up these IOUs?
Look, Jackie, if you're going to take that attitude, you can whistle for your dough. Nobody pushes me around.
Oh, that's right. I forgot. You're a pretty tough boy in pictures.
That's right.
Well, luckily, I never go to the movies.
That's the idea.
Let's understand each other, Ken. You owe me 19 grand. I expect to have it on the 23rd. If I don't, you'll
Hello, darling, I'm back.
Can't you see I'm busy, Laura?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, there's no need to apologize, Mrs. Marlowe. I'm Jackie Howard.
How do you do? I've heard so much about you.
I wish I could say it wasn't true.
Well, I'm sure I'm in the way, so if you'll excuse me.
Oh, no, don't bother. I was just leaving. Well, what do you say, Ken? Shall we make it for a week from Friday?
I'll do my best.
That's all I ask. Well, this has been a real pleasure, Mrs. Marlowe. Maybe we'll meet again.
I hope so.
A dirty bum.
What was he doing here?
None of your business.
Darling, I don't want to make a noise like a wife, but if you owe Jackie Howard
money...
I said
money, it's none of your business.
But don't you understand? I'm only thinking of you. If you're in a jam,
will you
I
stop want... nagging?
But all I want to
all
do
All you
is
want
to
do
able...
is drive me crazy. Where's my coat? I'm going to find a place where a man can have a drink in peace.
Oh, hi, Steve. Can I help you?
Yeah, is Mr. Marlowe... Never mind, I see him. Hello, Ken. I've been looking for you.
What do you want, Steve?
Just saw Laura. You're really living your part, aren't you, boy?
What?
The two-fisted He-Man. That's a beautiful shiner she's sporting.
Somebody asked
no,
you?
No, but I hate to see you louse her up. She's one in a million. Look how she stuck by you when you got in that mess out in Beverly Hills.
Why don't you mind your own business, Steve?
I try to.
Well, you're not very good at it. I pay you $200 a week to take care of my publicity. I haven't seen my name in print for months.
Sometimes a publicity man does a job by keeping his client's name out of the papers.
What kind of a crack is that?
Who squared that beef with that girl in Santa Monica and that little chicken Encino?
Look, Steve, if you don't like it, you know what you can do.
You know, I was just thinking, if National doesn't pick up your option, you're going to be in trouble.
Who says so? I could go to Metro or Fox.
Well, I got a scoop for you, boy. They wouldn't let you through the main gate. Your only chance is National. Now, you've got to behave yourself until they make up their minds. Kind of a jam did you get yourself into with Jackie Howard?
Oh, so Laura's been blabbing.
She hasn't been doing anything of the kind. I saw Jackie in the lobby. I put two and two together.
Well, if you'd stop adding and pay more attention to business, we'd all be better off. Why don't you get me some publicity?
Okay. Maybe you could stop a runaway horse.
Don't be funny.
I was just pointing out that putting three quarts of booze away isn't considered front page stuff anymore. You see, editors are funny. They
expect... Wait a minute. I got an idea. Suppose my life was threatened.
Oh, forget it.
Why? It sounds pretty good to me. Now, if we went to the cops...
In case you haven't heard, Ken, horsing around with the law is a pretty serious matter.
Okay. Isn't Mike Waring a buddy of yours?
Who?
That private dick they call a Falcon.
What about him?
Think he'd play ball?
No. No, Mike wouldn't touch anything that's phony.
Why would he have to know? Suppose we cooked up some anonymous phone call.
It's out.
Why? Because I thought of it?
Ken, don't be ridiculous.
Well, we're going to handle it my way. We'll hire the Falcon to be my bodyguard. Then you leak it to the papers. It'll be worth a couple of columns.
I don't like it, Ken.
Well, I don't like paying your salary while I dream up the ideas. Now go call Waring. Set up a date.
Well, that's the story, Mike. After the third phone call, Ken thought we ought to do something about it.
I see.
Not that I was worried, you understand. I can take care of myself, but I had to think of Laura.
Laura?
My wife. You know how a gal worries.
Mm-hmm. Tell me some more about these phone calls, Marlowe. Do you recognize the voice?
No, I thought it was a gag at first.
What convinced you otherwise?
Well, this morning, someone took a pot shot at me while I was playing golf with Steve.
Did you report it to the police?
He didn't want to, Mike, but I insisted.
What did they say?
They thought it was a publicity stunt.
Is this?
No.
You sure, Steve?
Oh, now, look, Mike, you've known me for how many years? 10, 12? I think I've always leveled with you.
Well, I'm sorry, but you can't blame me for being suspicious. Who did you talk to at headquarters?
A Sergeant Corbett. Now, there's a phony if I ever met one.
He happens to be a friend of mine.
Well, no offense, old man. I only meant...
Well, skip it. Have you any idea who might be after you?
No.
You indulging in any extracurricular activities?
What do you mean?
Women.
You take me for an idiot? I'm married to the greatest little gal in the world.
Mm-hmm. You owe anybody any money?
No, I'm the kind who pays his bills and always on the dot.
You sound too good to be true.
Huh?
The more I hear of this, the more I'm convinced Corbett was right.
Come again?
The way you tell it, you're the most popular man in the class.
Okay, if that's the way you feel, we'll get somebody else. There are other private detectives in New York.
And better, too.
Come on, Steve.
I'm sorry, Mike.
Forget it. It's not your fault. Just say it's a clash of personalities.
You coming, Steve?
Yeah. So long, pal. I'll be seeing you.
You bet. Give me a call before you leave town.
I will. Well, I hope you're satisfied.
I am. I think Waring's going to work out fine.
So help me, you're nuts. Didn't you hear him say
I know
say
what
that...
he said. He thinks this is a publicity stunt. Well, all he caught was the prologue. He'll play ball after the first act.
What are you talking about?
Let's find a phone. I gotta cast the show, and I know just the boy to play the lead.
Yeah?
Is Tex Riley around?
Who wants to know?
Tell him it's Ken Marlowe.
Why, you no good louse. How can you have the nerve?
Keep your shirt on, Tex. Bet you thought I forgot about that $100 you loaned me before I went to Hollywood.
Well, didn't you?
No, this is my first trip to New York in 6 years.
You could have mailed it.
Ah, that's too impersonal. I wanted to give it to you myself with a little bonus. How would you like to pick up an additional $500?
That don't sound like the Ken Marlowe I know and hate. What do I have to do?
Well, I got a little part I'd like you to try out for.
In a picture?
It's a play I'm going to produce on my own. But first, I'd like to see a dress rehearsal.
I don't get it.
Well, my wife doesn't know anything about this, and I'd like to test her reaction. If you meet me in the Creighton lobby in 20 minutes, we'll run over the script.
Laura, you better order some more ice. I'm running low.
Oh, all right, Ken.
While you're at it, get some ginger.
You expecting someone?
Well, Steve Nichols said he might drop around. Answer the door.
Just a second.
Well, hiya, sugar.
I beg your pardon.
I beg yours. Is the Hollywood hotshot in?
Who is it, Laura?
Well,
Never mind, I'll announce myself. Hiya, Marlowe.
Who the devil are you?
Oh, just an autograph hound.
Get out.
Now, where'd I put my pencil? I had it right here. Hey, look at what I found.
Ken!
What's the idea of the gun?
Well, you can't say you weren't warned, Marlowe. You owe a friend of mine some dough. He told you to get it up, since you did.
No, you can't.
Get out of my way,
sir. No.
Will you stop butting in?
I'm not afraid.
You don't know what you're doing.
Yes, I do.
Look, lady, I got nothing against you. Now get out of the way.
See what a hero he is, Ken? He's afraid of a woman half his size.
I'm warning you, baby. If you don't get out of the way, I'll...
Oh, that you, Haskell?
No, it's me, Sergeant.
Well, if it ain't that high-flying bird, the Falcon. Welcome to our little nest.
Who writes your material?
Fell out in California. He works real cheap.
He should. Say, was Ken Marlowe around to see you this morning?
Yeah. I spotted it for a publicity stunt.
Yeah, that's what I thought at first, too, but I changed my mind. Someone tried to gun him an hour ago.
Obviously, they didn't make it.
How do you know?
Well, I already talked to you, Mr. Marlowe. Here's the jacket of the bullet we found in the room. What do you make of it?
It's a blank.
That's right, Mr. Waring. It's a blank. Marlowe was in no danger at all.
Well, I guess that makes me the chump of the year.
I guess it does.
Well, I had a little help. Okay, Sarge, I'll be seeing you. I've got to thank the man who thought me so deserving.
That you, Laura?
Sorry to disappoint you, Marlowe.
Oh, hey, Waring. Sit down.
No, thanks. I just dropped by to congratulate you on a magnificent performance.
What's eating you?
It was a beautiful job of sucking me in. You hired whoever took that shot at you.
You're nuts.
What I can't figure out is how your wife got in the act. What happened? She ad-lib a part for herself?
Huh?
I don't think she knew the bullet was a blank. You don't rate a gal like that.
You got your nerve. Get out.
Does that mean I'm fired?
What do you think?
Good. Because I hate to hit a client. Come on, Marlowe. We can't end the scene with you on the floor. Your public would never stand for it. Now get up and make like a hero.
Hiya, Mike.
Oh, hiya, Sergeant. I didn't expect to see you again today.
Well, you know me. Always do the unexpected. Are you up to see Ken Marlowe?
Yeah.
What happened?
Nothing worth talking about.
No, you're too modest.
All right, so I slapped him a couple of times. He had it coming.
Maybe the slaps, but not the rest.
What are you talking about?
He's dead, Mike.
He's what?
He's out for all time. Were you wearing brass knucks?
You're crazy.
I wish I were. Better get your coat, fella. We got a long ride ahead.
An hour has passed since Mike Waring was informed Ken Marlowe was dead. And now at the scene of the crime, Sergeant Corbett gives our hero some fatherly advice.
Listen, Mike, I got it all figured out. I'm sure you'll be able to cop a plea.
What are you babbling about?
Well, it was self-defense, wasn't it? You didn't mean to kill him.
And I didn't. When I left here, he was at the other end of the room.
With the back of his head caved in?
Well, that's just it, Corbett. How did it get that way? I didn't slug him from behind.
Well, he must have hit it when he fell.
Against what, that sofa? Wouldn't hurt a fly.
How about the fireplace?
No, he wasn't anywhere near it. There'd be bloodstains if he were. No, there must be something around that caused the damage.
The familiar blunt instrument?
Yeah, let's see those fire tongs.
Clean.
Well, how about those bookends?
Oh, not a stain on them. Listen, Mike, maybe the killer took the weapon with him.
Does that mean you're absolving me?
If we can come up with some evidence... You think the murderer might have walked off with it?
I doubt it. A lot of blood flowed. I can't see anyone taking a chance on staining his clothes.
Well, he didn't leave it around for us to find.
Hey, wait a minute. There's something missing in this room.
What?
And that's just the trouble. I can't... I got it. Liquor.
What are you talking about?
Marlowe was a drinker. A boy like him would have at least one bottle around.
Say, you're right.
Where's the trash basket?
Probably in the pantry.
Well, let's get it.
The killer might gamble. The next time the chambermaid came through, she'd dump it without a second glance.
Yeah. Quite a collection, huh?
There's our baby.
Don't touch it.
I won't, but mine are probably the only fingerprints that aren't on it. Everyone else who was up here must have been invited to help himself.
Yeah, you're probably right. Haskell, take this down to the lab.
Well, now you're convinced I had nothing to do with this murder?
Yeah. But if you didn't kill Marlowe, who did?
That's what I intend to find out.
Why don't you stay out of this, Mike?
Oh, no. Whoever tailored this frame did a lovely job. It's just lucky I didn't fit the picture. You can't blame me if I want to get my hands on the artist.
I tell you, Mike, I don't know anything about it. First I heard of it was when the cops phoned me they found Ken's body.
Whose bright idea was this publicity stunt in the first place, Steve?
Ken's. I didn't want any part of it.
Then why did you bring him to me?
I couldn't help myself, Mike. I was working for the man.
Yeah, that's another thing I don't understand. How come you tied up with a heel like Marlowe?
The dough was good.
When did you last get it?
Huh?
According to what I hear now, he was strictly no pay. When did you get your last salary check? Come on, Steve. It'll be easy enough to find out.
3 months ago.
Then why did you stick? He was on the skids.
No, he wasn't. National had till Friday to pick up his option.
You think they would have?
Well, there's no telling. It was an even money bet.
Well, who had it in for him?
No one.
Look, Steve, we're no longer playing games. If he owed you dough, he must have owed others.
Jackie Howard.
Who's Jackie Howard?
He owns a gambling joint off the strip. Ken was into him for around 20 grand.
Is this Howard character in town?
Yeah, staying at the Brighton.
Okay, we got one suspect. Let's try for two. What about Mrs. Marlowe?
Don't talk like a chump. She was in love with the guy.
Well, he certainly didn't rate a wife like that.
Nobody does.
Oh, sounds like you go for her yourself.
Oh, don't be silly. You know I'm married.
I suppose you feel like a big brother to her.
That's exactly how I feel.
You know something, Steve? I believe you.
Thanks.
No, I mean it. I think Laura explains why you continued working for Marlowe. Maybe that's why you knocked yourself out suppressing those items that would have ruined him. You didn't want her hurt, right?
Yeah.
Why, Steve?
Won't make any sense to you, Mike.
Oh, try me.
First day I met her, she reminded me of Edith.
Edith?
My kid sister. She was married to a boy like Ken.
And what happened to her?
She's dead.
Oh, sorry.
Maybe she's better off.
So you transferred your feelings to Laura?
Anything wrong with that?
No, I think it's very commendable. Still, I wonder how Laura feels about it.
Huh?
Yeah, why don't I find out?
Oh, look, Mike, you're not to bother her. She knows nothing about Ken's murder.
Yeah, well, I've only got your word for it, Steve. Not that I don't believe you, understand. But I'd like to check these things for myself. I'll be seeing you, fella.
Who is it?
I'd like to see Laura Marlowe.
There's no one here by that name.
I know there is. This is Mike Waring, Mrs. Marlowe.
Please, go away.
I've got to talk to you. Believe me, I wouldn't disturb you, but it's important.
Come in.
Thanks.
How'd you know I was here?
Sergeant Corbett told me. I just saw Steve Nichols.
And Steve sent you here?
No, as a matter of fact, he insisted I leave you alone.
Well, why'd you come?
Because I want to solve your husband's murder.
Ken meant nothing to you.
He was a client.
He tricked you.
I still took his money. Besides, whoever killed him involved me. I don't forget things like that. Now tell me, what sort of a man was your husband?
You must have some idea.
Yes, but I'd like the woman's viewpoint.
He was wonderful.
Oh, come now, Angel. You can't expect me to buy that. I heard...
I don't care what you heard. Sure, he took a drink once in a while. Is there anything wrong with that?
What about slapping you around?
He never did.
Well, you can't blame me for jumping to conclusions. It would take a blind man not to notice those bruises on your face and arm. How did you get them?
I fell.
Question is, did Ken push you?
How dare you?
Now look, Mrs. Marlowe, I don't mean to be obnoxious, but we've got a murder to solve. Did your husband play around on the outside?
No.
What about those stories?
Lies, every one of them. They were started by his enemies.
Oh, so he was just a misunderstood kid.
No. I understood him, and that's all that counted.
All right, Mrs. Marlowe. I think you're telling the truth.
I'm overwhelmed.
Well, you should be, because if Jackie Howard doesn't turn out to be a liar, I won't know what to do. Take care of yourself, Angel. I got to run along.
Front, take the general inspector. 419, please.
Telegram, Jackie Howard.
Right here, boy.
Hello, Jackie. My name is Mike Waring.
What's the idea?
Well, this is the only way I could think of to get acquainted. I'd like to talk to you about Ken Marlowe.
You a reporter?
No, private detective.
Who are you representing?
Myself. I understand Marlowe was in hock to you.
Where, you understand that from?
Oh, you mind holding that match? Thanks.
Who told you Marlowe was into me?
Steve Nichols.
Well, I got a flash for Steve. Marlowe took care of those IOUs this morning.
I don't see how. He owed you 19 grand. According to the police, he had only 800 bucks in his checking account.
He paid me in cash.
Oh, got it out of his mattress, I suppose.
Well, now that you mention it, I believe he did.
You know, Jackie, you're a welcome change from everybody else in this case.
Am I?
Yeah, they were telling the truth.
Suppose I showed you the money.
Well, you probably could. A boy like you always travels well-heeled. But can you prove it came from Marlowe?
Well, let's look at it another way. Can you prove it didn't?
If I can, it'll make you a choice suspect.
You know, Waring, there's one thing I don't like about New York. There must be something in the air that makes everybody run off at the mouth.
I suppose it's different on the coast?
Well, we have a special treatment for those who do.
I'd like to see it.
I'll have to discuss it first with a fellow Californian. But don't be discouraged. I'll get back to you.
Yes?
Hello, Steve.
Oh, hiya, Jackie. I thought by now you'd be on your way back to the coast.
You thought wrong. Say, you got yourself a nice little spot here.
Look, Jackie, I don't want to seem rude, but I was just on my way out.
Oh, relax. I won't stay long. Too bad about Cannon.
Yeah.
What do you think killed him?
I have no idea.
Oh, you must have, Steve. You're a bright boy.
No, I'm not.
Maybe you're right. Now, I had you pegged as the kind who kept his nose clean.
And don't I?
Not in my book. Why don't you tell Mike Waring that Marlowe owed me money?
He asked me.
You're the real helpful type, aren't you?
I do my best, yeah.
Sometimes it doesn't pay. People don't appreciate it.
Oh, he's dirty.
What's the matter, boy? Can't you catch your breath?
Dirty.
Maybe that's a good thing. You talk too much anyway. Little of Doc Howard's treatment may break the habit. Hold still, Steve. I'm afraid this is gonna hurt.
Hours have passed since Steve Nichols received a little of Jackie Howard's specialized treatment. And now in Steve's hotel room, we find him recuperating from the visit.
Where's the doctor? You sure you gave him the right room number?
Now, take it easy, Laura. He'll be here. All right, Steve, try some of this. Come on, it's good for what ails you.
Mike.
Don't talk, just drink it down.
I'm all right. How did you find me?
She called me.
How do you feel, darling?
Laura...
Here, raise your head up. Fix the pillow.
You're a doll.
Who did it, Steve?
Huh?
Who gave you the shellacking?
I don't know.
Come on, Steve. You can't hold out.
Look, must you question him now?
Yes, I'm afraid I must. This is all tied up with your husband's murder. It was Jackie Howard, wasn't it?
Yes.
Why did he do it?
I have no idea.
You know anything that would definitely mark him as Marlowe's killer?
No.
You sure, Steve? Anything at all?
Can't think of a thing.
You've got to. It's our only chance of making this come out the way we want.
I don't understand.
Well, Jackie must have felt he had good reason to give Steve that beating.
What do you mean?
Well, you don't feel Laura killed her husband.
What?
Oh, now look, Mike, I told you.
I take it you don't, so that brings us back to Jackie again. Now, what would be his motive in killing Marlowe?
Well, Ken owed him money.
Well, how could he be sure Marlowe wouldn't raise it?
Ken couldn't. We were broke.
But you would have been on Easy Street if National picked up his option.
I don't think they would.
Still, where there's life, there's hope. You told me they had till the 23rd. Today is the 18th.
So?
So Jackie would be sucker not to wait it out.
What are you getting at?
Well, if neither you nor Jackie killed your husband, who does that leave?
I don't know.
Yes, you do. It's Steve.
No!
Yes, that's why Howard gave him that pasting. He felt Steve cost him 19 grand.
I don't believe it. You didn't do it, Steve. Tell me. Tell me, I gotta know.
He's right, Laura.
Why? Why? Ken never hurt you.
No. But he hurt you.
He was the only man I ever loved, and you killed him.
But don't you see, honey, I was
don't
only trying...
Don't touch me. I hate you.
Oh, Laura, listen.
Get away from me.
Mike, explain to...
I can't.
He was no good.
And she loved him. I'm sorry, Steve. I've got to call the police. What do you say, Mike? Some more coffee?
No, thanks, Sergeant.
Oh, come on, come on. Cheer up. What are you dragging for?
Well, you must have some idea. Steve Nichols was my friend.
And he committed a murder.
Well, there's no question about that.
Tell me something. Was he in love with Laura?
If he was, he was able to kid himself into believing it was strictly platonic. He thought Marlowe was hard-timing her.
Well, he was right.
No, he wasn't.
You mean there was nothing to those stories about Marlowe playing around?
Oh, they were true enough. But they didn't mean a thing to Laura. She was in love with him, and that's all that counted. This goes to prove it's awful dangerous to play God. You never know what's best for other people.
Hi, this is singer Larry Stevens, and you are listening to The Glowing Dial with your host, Big John and Steve.
And we are back with you, Big John and Steve. As previously mentioned, this is episode Pod 91 of The Glowing Dial, where we have been celebrating Father's Day and have presented another tribute to those adventurous detectives. And we just heard The Adventures of the Falcon, The Case of the Falling Star from Thursday, May 15th, 1952, over NBC. And Steve, you know, that brings us to the end of another show.
We've been very adventurous, but it's time to say goodbye.
M-I-C-K... Oh, no, wrong show. Before we go, because I see, you know, Paul Whiteman and his orchestra, the ghost thereof, are waiting to materialize behind us with our closing theme. We have something to take care of first. A little preview of what's coming up on the Glowing Dial in future weeks here. Starting June the 30th, 2019, we have episode Pod 92, where Steve and I celebrate Independence Day and present a tribute to Willis Cooper and Arch Obler. And I suppose you can guess by that that we're going to play a couple of Quiet Please episodes and a couple of Lights Out. Everybody. And those two Quiet Please are probably going to be the last ones that we present. We've given you all the ones in decent sound that we can. The rest of them survive with so much surface noise, it's really a pain on some of them to hear the dialogue. And that's a shame because this was such an excellent series. Of course, we have our favorite episodes, you know, The Thing on the Forbo Board, Northern Lights with the little Isabella caterpillars, Calling All Souls. There are so many good ones. Adam and the Darkest Day. A lot of the good ones we presented already. So check the Glowing Dial archives for those. And that's going to come to you starting June 30th, 2019. Starting July 21st, 2019... we have episode Pod 93 of The Glowing Dial. Steve and I celebrate Stu's birthday, our good friend Stu, who has been with us on some of the shows and some of the live shows, co-hosting with me. And we're going to present a group of spooky shows because we know he likes that kind of stuff. We have episodes of Dark Fantasy, The Witch's Tale, The Hermit's Cave, also known as the Little Theater of the Air. That one came right from WJR Detroit, right out of locally here. And then an episode of Mystery in the Air with Peter Lorre. So that's coming at you July 21st, 2019. And one more. Starting August 11th, 2019, we have Pod 94, which is where Steve and I go on vacation. So we have episodes of The Bickersons, My Favorite Husband, The Jack Benny Program, and The Mysterious Traveler, all talking about vacation in one form or another. So once again, that's Pod 94 coming to you starting August 11th, 2019. And there we go. That's a preview of what's coming up on the Glowing Dial. Steve, you know, that's about it. I think Mr. Whiteman is just starting to materialize back there.
He's giving us the signal right now.
All right, Paul, okay. Take it away. Okay, he's keeping it soft so we can talk here. All right, folks, some reminders before we get on out of here. Don't forget all those great places that you can hear the Glowing Dial Tri-Weekly Podcast. GlowingDial.com. Old Time Radio Network is part of Jerry Handiga's OTRSite.com. YouTube. TuneIn. Google Play Music. iTunes. And the Internet Archive. And we are looking for more spots to be able to make the Glowing Dial available. So if you know of any places, please feel free to drop us an email and let us know. Visit our Cafe Press store. We've got some great items with the Glowing Dial logos on them. We'll design more as soon as we sell these. Get my hint? Head over to our bookstore in association with Amazon.com. Just click through there and do all your Amazon.com shopping there. You'll be helping us out here at the Glowing Dial. We thank you for that. Don't forget our Facebook page. We were on break 100 likes on that, and we need your help to do that. So visit us there and like us. Donations, yeah, as little or as much as you can do. That'll help us out here at the Glowing Dial. Maintaining equipment and bandwidth and other things through PayPal.com. And the logo is right there on our main page, GlowingDial.com. We're also working on a Patreon page, but that's going to be a little while because I have some more work to do on that. So stay tuned. The live show, folks, is on hiatus due to my work schedule, my finances, and my health. So if we can return, we will, because we really enjoyed doing that. And I want to get Steve doing some of the live stuff with us. Lastly, our sources of information. We want to thank all those. Jerry Handiga's Vintage Radio Logs, Wikipedia, OTRCat.com, John Dunning's On the Air, the Encyclopedia of Old Time Radio, and Tune In Yesterday, which was the predecessor of that book. Wonderful work and a wonderful guy. We had a great interview with John Dunning, available in the archives. The good folks at Digital Deli 2 doing some wonderful work out there. And thank you once again to Jerry Handigas for everything that you do, Jerry, for this show. For me personally, I want to thank you. Big John and Steve saying, until next time, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, think big, keep watching the skies, and we'll see you next time.